Perfect. We're good to start. Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's event. I'll begin by thanking Kinga, Gajda, who's from the University, Jagiellonian University here in Krakow, who has kindly opened this reunified building of the political sciences, European studies, international studies here in Krakow, and obviously thanks to our new Eastern Europe team here based in Krakow, who have been very kind to help and organize this event together with the help of Adam Balcer. And thanks to all our partners and guests who've come, made all the way to Krakow to talk about a topic which might sometimes seem in these days a very, not the main focus of our discussions, but I think it also, by meeting here and talking about German reunification from the perspective of the neighbors, we're actually talking about what's happening these days around us. I mean, our expectations, and maybe it helps us to understand European politics much better than we actually think. So maybe we can work on the experience of this German reunification. We met in Strasbourg a few weeks ago and we talked about the German-French couple. Then we talked about the German-French tandem. And once I couldn't agree, which is the better way of describing the relationship. Now we're here in Poland and Krakow, which is one of the main gateways into Europe, into the European Union for the people fleeing the Russian war in Ukraine. And it happened so that even before the war, when Ivona and I had together with Kinga Gajda started working on the concept of this meeting here today, they were thinking about migration. And I think if we connect these two things, I think if on the one hand, if we connect our expectations or the expectations of the neighboring states of Germany about its reunification, about its contemporary role in Europe, and on the other hand, if we connect with the migration and, you know, the horrible plight of people from Ukraine because of the Russian atrocities, these two things actually come together fairly well. And I hope that we can have an interesting conversation here today. Hello to Basil and our guests online on Zoom and the people watching on Facebook. And thank you very much for your time. And let's hope we have an interesting conversation that we can then develop into some ideas that we can maybe implement practically in the real world. I won't be making any bad jokes. I'll leave them for later. My colleagues have asked me not to make any bad jokes about German reunification and about Lithuanian collaboration. So we leave that for later. Now I'll give the floor to Kinga Gajda, who's our host today, and she'll say a few words about the event and the program that we have today.
Yeah. Thank you, Laurynas. Hi, hello. On behalf of the head of the Institute of European Studies and my own, I would like to welcome you to our seminar. And I'm really very glad to see all of you, to see our panelists, our experts, members of consortium, invited guests, students, the audience, everybody who is here with us and everybody who joins us alone. We are going to discuss the topic of the reunification of Germany and its result after 30 years. As we are in Poland, so we are interested in the reunification from the Polish perspectives. As Laurynas mentioned, Dr. Ivona Reinhardt and I have decided to focus on the issue of migration, because the migration was and still is accompanying very important events in the history, such as the reunification of Germany, such as accession of Poland to EU, and now the war in the Ukraine. And our seminar is divided into four parts. We begin with the key speech about the current EU and the reunification of Germany, then talk about Polish and German perspectives of the reunification of Germany. The third part is the panel about the human dimensions of reunifications, migrations between Poland and Germany. And in the end, students present their poster, the result of their hard work. And so I hope we all will have a nice and reflective day here at the Jagiellonian University. And on behalf of the director of the Institute of European Studies and my own, I would like to wish you a nice day and a fruitful seminar. So welcome. And I give the voice to our keynote speaker.
Unmute.
Now you can hear me, yes? It's okay?
Yes.
Fantastic. Well, thank you for the invitation. It's a pleasure and privilege to be with you. I'm unfortunately today online from Łódź. I'm attending here, I'm participating in a conference dedicated to the heritage of the review Kultura, Paryska Kultura of Jerzy Giedroyć. You know quite well, I suppose, the work of Jerzy Giedroyć, especially as one of the protagonists of Polish-German, but also Polish, especially Polish-Ukrainian reconciliation. Well, the topic, I modified a little bit the topic of my lecture. The topic is the importance of the 1989-91 revolutions and also the German unification, because it's an effect of these revolutions. The importance of these revolutions for a democratic European identity and current German-Polish partnerships. I would like to present you now the five theses of my lecture. The first one will be the disintegration of the Soviet Empire of the post-war European order is still going on. Russia's war against Ukraine is also war against the democratic outcome of the 1989-91 revolutions. The second thesis will be, in the years 1989-91, we have witnessed the birth of political Europe in which we live today. The fall of the communist rule in the late 80s and early 90s opened not only the path to German unification and Polish independence, but gave a new impulse to the idea of political integration of Europe. The third thesis will be the civic revolutions of 89 were or are not an important motive of the current European culture of remembrance, unfortunately even in Germany. The fourth will be 1989 is a turning point also in global history for two reasons, for two further reasons, the digital revolution and the beginning of the violent transformation of China into an authoritarian but capitalist state. And the last thesis will be the dispute, the debate over the interpretation of the revolutionary years 1989-91 is also a dispute over the future of European democracy. Ladies and gentlemen, let me start with some quotes, some voices from the Ukraine about the current situation in Europe, about the fragile order, about Putin's war, not only against Ukraine, but about the heritage of the civic 89 revolutions. The process of the disintegration of the Soviet Empire is not finished, and the post-Cold War European order is not stable. Putin's Russia is fighting against the Central and Eastern European civic and democratic culture that changed the continent after 1989. I would like to quote an article or an interview published in one of the current issues of New Eastern Europe. This is this one, an interview with Professor Sergei Ploche. It was published last year, months before the Russian invasion, but I think it is one of the most important interpretations of the process we are facing now, not only in Ukraine, but in the whole, on the whole continent. I would like to quote Professor Ploche. The most tragic outcome of the fall of the Soviet Union is the violence and wars which continue till today. For a long period, there existed a belief or mythology of a peaceful disintegration of the Soviet bloc, of the Soviet Union. In my opinion, underlined Professor Ploche, this was mainly the result of the Western leaders and publics that East Central Europe was allowed to leave the Soviet bloc without violent conflict. But the Russian aggression against Ukraine and the annexation of the Crimea are basically among the long-term consequences of this collapse. That is why the dissolution of the Soviet Union is still ongoing and not peaceful. Words from an interview made last year before the invasion. A second very important voice of one of the leaders, I would say, protagonists of the Polish-Ukrainian reconciliation dialogue, Mikola Kniażycki, last year on the 1st of September, on a conference that we made together with Kolegium Europy Wschodniej in Gdańsk, who also underlined that the goal or the political ambition of Putin is not only the destruction of an independent Ukraine, but it's a policy against the European order or civic culture that was established after 1989. I would like to quote Mikola Kniażycki, 1st September last year. Moscow's goal is to destroy the Ukrainian state, to subordinate the Belarusian and Baltic states, to break up the European Union and NATO, and to establish a new concert of great powers. And the vacuum that has subsequently arisen, complete with spheres of influence and a dominant role for Russia, the state with the largest nuclear arsenal and the largest army in terms of numbers. Ladies and gentlemen, the years 1989-91, we were witnesses of the birth of political Europe in which we live today, as I mentioned, underlined in my first thesis. 30 years ago, revolution started by ordinary citizens not only led to the collapse of communist regimes in Central and Eastern Europe, but also and above all, changed the face of the entire continent. In Germany, this revolutionary upheaval is mainly attributable to the reform policy initiated by Mikhail Gorbachev, the policy of glasnost and perestroika. The role played by the civil society in this process of renewal, especially the Polish Solidarity Movement, is, however, usually underestimated. This forgotten mutual interaction between solidarity struggle for freedom and Gorbachev's reforms was aptly summed up by the Polish historian Jerzy Holzer. According to him, the birth of solidarity in August 1980 and its political consequences after Gorbachev took power in 85 became the actual catalyst for perestroika, which in turn accelerated further changes in Poland and in Central Europe. Solidarity's leaders used Gorbachev reforms in the late 80s to bring about the roundtable talks that began already in February 1989. Their conclusion at the beginning of April 89 opened the door to the democratization of Poland. The re-legalization of solidarity in April 89 and the first partially free elections in Poland on the 4th of June 1989 triggered a chain reaction that led to the roundtable discussions in Hungary and the end of the spring of the same year and to the mass protests in East Germany and Czechoslovakia in the autumn. The last link in this revolutionary chain of events was the fall of the Berlin Wall on the 9th November of 1989. This was the symbolic climax of the European Revolution, in which it was solidarity that formed the vanguard, led to the collapse of the communist regime and extended the scope of freedom. The victory of the civil revolutions in Central Europe in 1989 offered Germany an unexpected opportunity for unification, which took place only a year later on the 3rd of October 1990. German unification would not have been possible, however, without the Allies' agreement, but also without the acceptance of the neighbors. The basic condition for unification was reconciliation, not only with Germany's Western neighbors, but also to an equal extent with the Eastern, especially with Poland. Thanks to Germany being united and integrated with Western structures, Poland had the West Rite at its doorstep. Solidarity leaders looked favorably on these geopolitical changes, supported a very intensive and short German pathway to unification in 1990. The reunification of Germany resulted in the withdrawal of Soviet troops from Central Europe. Moscow thus lost its military control over Central Europe. The former colonies of the Soviet Empire were transformed into sovereign nations. Civic revolutions in Poland, Hungary, East Germany, and Czechoslovakia also strengthened the desire for freedom among the peoples of the Soviet Union itself. In addition to the Baltic nations, a return to national sovereignty and independence from Moscow was also demanded by Ukrainians, Georgians, Armenians, and Belarusians. In 1989, Moscow could not and would not use tanks to suppress the revolution in Poland, the GDR, or Hungary. In the face of mass protests by the citizens of these countries, the risk of an uncontrolled political crisis was too great. From the point of view of Soviet authorities, the peaceful change was to help alleviate the crisis that broke out in the Soviet domain and thus strengthen the center of power in Moscow. This calculation was doomed to failure when confronted with reality, however, as the Central European Revolution of 1989 had already spread to the entire empire. In this situation, the communists in the USSR itself partly opted for a force-based solution, which was supposed to stop the uncontrolled changes. Gorbachev, for example, what is not quite well known or forgotten in Germany especially, Gorbachev sent troops to the Baltic republics to stop the process of creating sovereign states. Meanwhile, in the summer of 1991, the hardliners of the communist regime sought to overthrow Gorbachev, thereby only accelerating the collapse of the Soviet Empire. The Russian Federation was born on the ruins of the Bolshevik Empire. The Baltic states regained their sovereignty, and the Ukrainians, after many unsuccessful attempts in the 20th century, were finally able to create their own state. The newly emerged Ukraine gave up its nuclear arsenal. In return, Russia guaranteed the inviolability of Ukraine's borders. It was an important element of the European political order after 1989, an order which Russian President Vladimir Putin questioned by starting a war in Ukraine in 2014. Ladies and gentlemen, the fall of the communist rule in the early 1990s gave a new impulse to the idea of political integration in Europe. In 1993, the countries of the West, transformed the European Economic Community into the European Union, emphasizing the political foundations of integration and strengthening economic ties. The Maastricht Treaty of 1992 deepened financial integration and set the goal of introducing a common European currency. It was especially the French president, François Mitterrand, it was his precondition for the German unification, a very important idea, to create a European currency, a common European currency, well, as one of the fundaments of a new, not only economic, but also political order that will integrate a new united, big German state and economy. I think it was a very important idea of integrating Germany because, that's my thought, without the euro, Germany would have less solidarity with other states. Euro creates a strong independence on the European continent, inside the European Union. It's not only a financial and economic order, it is also, I would say, an instrument. The euro is also an instrument of political integration. What is also important to underline, what is also forgotten, countries that had been neutral during the Cold War, such as Austria, Sweden, Finland, joined the European Union in 1995 and strengthened both the economic and political attractiveness of the European Union. The revolutions of 1989 fundamentally changed the face of Europe. But these events of 3 decades ago are deeply buried in the memory of today's Europeans, and their significance has diminished. The peoples of Europe have firmly entrenched themselves in their identities, traditions, and cultures, enclosing themselves in a narrow circle of their own problems. The 30th anniversary of the Polish Roundtable and the first partly free parliamentary elections on June 89, or the Hungarian Roundtable, all these events have hardly been registered in the European media or in the European political scene 3 years ago. And yet the 4th June of 1989 is a date of a crucial importance for world history. On that day, solidarity won partially free elections. The citizens deprived the communists of their political legitimacy at the ballot box. And in China, tanks were used to bloodily suppress the democratic, peaceful civil movement. While Poland paved the way to democracy and a market economy, the Chinese leaders of the Communist Party decided to defend a one-party dictatorship by choosing the path of capitalism without an open civil society. The roundtable in Poland, the legalization of solidarity, and the reform policy initiated by Gorbachev inspired directly Chinese youth in spring 1989 to peacefully press for the reform of Chinese communism. When at the end of May 89, workers joined the students to form Beijing's free trade unions, the Politburo of the Chinese Communist Party realized that the dangerous political mixture was in the pipeline that could lead to the birth of a Chinese solidarity. In light of the Polish experience, the leadership of the Chinese Communist Party decided to stop this process by force. The forgotten significance of the European and even global political dimension of 89 is particularly surprising in Germany. After all, United Germany, or the Berlin Republic, is the child of this revolution. Germany has definitely benefited from the pioneering role played by Polish, Hungarian, Czech societies, but today this fact is largely forgotten in the Federal Republic. In the major German museums or school books, the European context, mainly Polish-German, but also the Soviet Union breakdown of the watershed epoch of 1989-91 is almost absent. There is no Polish motive in describing, for example, remembering Germany of unification, although Poland, the foreign minister Skubiszewski, took part in July 1990 in the 2+4 negotiations. One of the main challenges was the Polish-German border. Yes, the border treaty signed in November 1990 is also part of the unification process, and even I would say the neighborhood treaty signed on the 17th of June 91 is part of the fundament of the process of German unification. All this is absent in German official commemoration. Western Europe had underestimated the great, also Western Europe had underestimated the great impact of the political revolutions in Central Europe on the whole continent. The year 89 was an epoch-making event, but for most Western Europeans, it meant only the final collapse of an inefficient political and economic system on the periphery of the continent. Transition and democratization were concepts that only concerned Europeans living east of the Elbe, rather than those in the West. Although also underestimated was the fact that Eastern Europeans contributed something important, something new, their own political experience of living under dictatorship, cultural skills, a good education in all areas of knowledge, and the ambitions of new citizens and new Europeans. In Germany, this underestimation of the East was clearly evident. Thus, after German reunification, I felt that most Germans thought that the old Bonn Republic would continue to exist after the 3rd of October 1990, but in an extended form to include the new Bundesländer, the new regions, the former GDR. It was believed that profound changes would only affect Berlin and the eastern regions. This was the attitude and atmosphere of the time. It was often said at the time that the Eastern Länder was waiting to catch up on the modernization work. It was now up to the East after 89 to adopt the democratic models that had been tried and tested in the West and adapt them to local or regional conditions. This vision of change was shared not only by Western Germans and Europeans in the West, but also by many post-communist citizens who initially saw their own transformation as catching up modernization. Or you have this notion in German, nachholende Modernisierung. The fall of communism was generally interpreted as a triumph for the West. It has been in recent years that many people began to understand that after 89 or 91, a completely different European community and the case of Germany, a completely new republic had been established. It seems that in Western Europe, this awareness of the fundamental dimension of the revival of Europe after 89 took a very long time to emerge. Ladies and gentlemen, the spirit of the times, critical of Europe with a fascination with closer political identities or new nationalism, are rooted in another revolution of 1989. It was then that another dramatic cultural change took place, the effects and consequences of which can only be seen today. I'm thinking here of the digital revolution. In 1989 is, on the one hand, the year of the fall of the Iron Curtain, and on the other hand, the beginning of a global information network, a digital opening and globalization in its present form. On the 12th of March 1989, British IT specialist Timothy John Berners-Lee presented the concept of a new form of data proceeding and data mediation to the European Organization for Nuclear Research, CERN. He then developed worldwide web tools, such as the page description language, the first browser, and the first web server. Three decades ago, political and economic systems in the East and national borders changed almost instantly. In addition, the technological revolution affected all areas of our lives, private and public communication, our professional life, running business, the world of media and culture, the public sphere as a whole, and the way democracy functions. Digital communication have revolutionized all areas of our lives. After 1989, we were focused on the post-communist transformation of Europe, deepening European integration and catching up on modernization, Modernisierung, in the eastern part of the continent. In the meantime, an epoch-making cultural revolution embracing all Europeans took place. In the light of this coincidence of political and cultural revolutions, the epoch-making changes of 1989 resemble the period after 1789, the time of the Enlightenment, the French Revolution, and the great technological changes that led to the 19th century industrialization. In 1989 is a crucial date in the history of the world, and therefore it is deeply astonishing that Europeans approach this peculiar place of remembrance so indifferently. Perhaps this attitude should not be regarded as disdainful, but as a deliberate escape from the memory of the extent of epoch-making changes after 1989, the consequences of which are increasingly perceived as a threat. This distanced and critical approach to the consequences of 1989 can be seen throughout Europe, including at the source of the revolution. What generates the anti-democratic, right-wing populist and xenophobic sentiments today is only to a limited extent due to the dissatisfaction with the economic and social consequences of the post-communist transformation. Extreme political attitudes provoke a desire to protect yourself against cultural changes, which turned out to be more radical than expected. In the West, the distanced view of the new Europeans, the longing for the old, smaller Western Europe, fuels the new political radicalism. And in the East, its source as the hostility of right-wing populists to the multicultural and cosmopolitan part of Europe, that is the supposedly political naive Western Europe, which promotes the attitudes of tolerance and at the same time ignores the cultural traditions of the eastern part of the continent. And finally, this nationalism confirms the belief of many Western Europeans that there is a natural borderline for democracy and political rationality in Europe, and this is traditionally runs, and it traditionally runs along the Elbe River, that is the former Iron Curtain. Ladies and gentlemen, this will be my last thesis. This is a quote, whoever controls the past controls the future, wrote George Orwell in his novel 1984. The dispute over the interpretation of the revolutionary years 1989-1991 is also a dispute over the future of democracy. In Western Europe, in Central Europe, also, we have been experienced in Putin's historical speeches interpretation, also in the eastern part of our continent. This mechanism can also be observed on the European level, that when interpreting history, we decide about the future of our continent. The political integration of Europe is hindered on the one hand by the lack of knowledge about democratic traditions, and on the other hand by the lack of European narrative embracing all parts of the continent. Western Europe is still dominated by the narrative of European integration in the post-war period, based on German-French reconciliation and the 1957 treaties of Rome. The cultures and civil societies of Central and Eastern Europe, which led to the revolutions of 1989-91, are almost absent from this European narrative. Professor Alaida Asman has analyzed this significant rift in European identity very well. In one of her latest books, Der europäische Traum, The European Dream, Professor Asman broadens the perception of the post-war history of the continent by creating a pan-European narrative. In my opinion, Asman proposes an accurate interpretation of European integration as a process marked by two fundamental dates, 1945 and 1989. Professor Asman even speaks of a dual funding of Europe in those years. After 1945, in reaction to the Second World War and the genocide of the Jews or other nations, but especially facing Holocaust, Shoah, a new foundation of values and a new anti-nationalist vision of Europe was built. After 1989, the societies of Eastern Europe added to this the experience of 30 years of Soviet empire, Soviet dictatorship. I quote Professor Asman, without a common awareness of the dual funding of Europe, writes Asman, Europe cannot exist, cannot overcome the crisis that afflicted it, and cannot renew itself without a European agreement on this history and its continuing consequences. It is impossible to work out a common course of action, because the sense of orientation is just that, to overcome the current crisis and take the course towards a common future. Awareness of European traditions and overcoming European crises are two closely related skills, as it were, two sides of the same coin. Without a European historical consciousness, there will be no democratic future for Europe. Ladies and gentlemen, Laida Assmann's book is a testimony to the rediscovery of the importance of the 1989-91 revolutions for the process of European political integration. Putin's war against the outcome of these democratic changes of 89-91 can reinforce the process of the political integration of Europe. This process, unfortunately, this war, this conflict, is also an opportunity for Germans and Poles to rediscover political common ground, common democratic heritage, or common democratic traditions. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you. I hope you can hear me, because I don't see anybody and hear anybody.
Thank you very much, Basil. That was really great to start our first panel. Thank you again.
Hello, Adam.
I'd like to invite Małgorzata, Kopka-Piątek, and Felix Ackerman. Please join me. Oh, my name is Adam Balcer. I'm program director at the Nowak-Jeziorański College of Eastern Europe. We are based in Wrocław, but we have also my friends, like, for example, Ivona and Adam Reichardt. They are editors of Eastern Europe. They're based here. And we co-organized this event with the Jagiellonian University. Of course, I'd like to thank very much Kinga, Gajda for helping us and providing us with this very nice venue. A few words about our project, Reunify. Our project is co-funded by the European Commission within the framework of the program Europe for Citizens and Strand European Remembrance. And within the framework of the project, we established a consortium with our partners, neighbors, from the Netherlands. We have the University of Groningen, from France, think tank Eurocreative. From Czechia, we have another think tank, Europeum. And from Germany, from Berlin, we have Institute for Europäische Politik. And of course, besides our events, we are going to, with students, because that's the project which is dedicated to the legacy of the reunification of Germany. We would like to focus especially on the relevance of these events to show how still they are, in our opinion, important for the European Union. And that's why we are trying to engage young people, students especially. That's why we are here at the university. And of course, we are working with students in order to prepare posters, and we'll present them in Dresden in September this year. And of course, we are going to publish a special edition of the New Eastern Europe dedicated to this topic. So that's all about the project. And right now, let me introduce our distinguished speakers. It's really a great pleasure for me to moderate this panel. So on my right, I have Małgorzata, Kopka-Piątek. She's right now director of the European program at the Institute of Public Affairs, independent Polish think tank based in Warsaw. She is in fact from Wrocław, Breslau, so the city where we are based, and which is of course a very important city concerning Polish-German history. And she started her career working at the youth exchange program, established by both governments at the beginning of the 90s. Then she moved to the famous, very good German foundation, Heinrich Boll Stiftung, and she had worked there for 15 years. Then, thank you very much. Then I'm moving to Felix. Felix Ackerman has graduated from the University of Viadrina, which is based at also London Schools of Economics, and Viadrina University is based in Frankfurt an der Oder, the border town. And he's a great, really great expert on Belarus, Eastern Europe. He published a book which originally was published in Palimpsest Grodno. That's a history of Grodno in the 20th century, a very good book. It was published in German. It was translated into Belarusian last year, and it's going to be translated pretty soon into Polish. And he, for I think 5 years, he worked at, taught at the University of Vilnius and other universities based in Vilnius, the capital of Lithuania, including this Belarusian private university, independent university. And right now, last but not least, he works at the German Historical Institute in Warsaw. And that's all, thank you. And right now, after this maybe too long presentation, introduction and so on, I will start with a very basic question, because we are at the premises of the Jagiellonian University. Summer exams are approaching. So let's start from this basic question. In your opinion, maybe I will oversimplify a little bit. Let's imagine that you are still students, and that's a very nice time. And I remember all those yesterdays and so on. And please think a little bit, what would be, in case of exam, main lesson that, in your opinion, we should draw from these events reunification of Germany, which are still relevant, important for us? If you can make some links to the current Russian aggression against Ukraine, it would be even more interesting, but maybe it's too challenging. But nevertheless, let's try. What does it mean for you, the main lesson which we can pick up from the reunification of Germany? And I will start. With Felix. Please, Felix.
Yeah, thank you very much for the kind introduction. For the that, of course, the fall of the Berlin Wall, where I actually grew right next to the wall, is something we commemorate, and what is the point of reference for our thinking of the end of the communist rule in Central Eastern Europe, including Eastern Germany. And we remember much less about 1990. And I think that's my main point, that the way how the reunification of Germany was played out in diplomatic way created, on the one hand, the security architecture, which it is the basis of the security architecture in Europe at large. And this is something what came to an end on the 24th of February of this year, very much. And I think if we look into the way how the reunification was like designed in 1990, we see that the experience of the peaceful revolutions of something what Basil addressed in his speech was not very present. Markus Meckel represented GDR there, and he had a hard time to getting through. His voice was actually not heard. He was basically a side player. Like his idea that Germany as a reunified sovereign state should be neutral and not part of NATO was not even taken into consideration. And I think this is an important point we should remember. And as a result, I think if we look at the way how particularly Helmut Kohl made use of his position and particularly of the strong economic position of the existing Bundesrepublik Deutschland, like of West Germany, I think that there is a long-term outcome which has an impact on the current situation, but also on German-Polish relations, which we might address later. And what I have in mind is basically that in this particular situation, being in close relations with the United States, that West Germany took part in playing off very much the Soviet Union and the weakness of Gorbachev in this very particular situation in spring 1990, the deep crisis of the economy of the Soviet Union, the deep crisis of the political system of the Soviet Union, and what Basil addressed, this already starting process of falling apart, which started in March 1990 with the declarations of independence of Lithuania. And so what I have in mind is that that Germany is started back then to think about it, like we have a habit of thinking about Germany as kind of a post-national European pan-European state, but what we see in if we look closely into 1990 and the way how Kohl played out particularly the economic crisis in the Soviet Union is that there is a specific asymmetry built in the relations between Germany and Poland in particular. That there was this short moment when Kohl did not accept even the eastern border still in early 1990, and also vis-a-vis the Soviet Union and then later Russia. What I mean is that the price Germany paid for peace, for coming to terms basically with the post-war configuration of occupied country, which is formally still was in 1989, was much too low. So I think it was a very successful event to have 2+4. It was a very good time window used by all these actors, and the outcome was a big success, and it was a luck for Germany and for Europe to have Germany reunified in a peaceful way, to have it included into the European Union, to have it somehow built into the West. That's all true, and I'm not arguing with this, but I think that the price Germany paid was much too low. Like 11 billion marks for paying for the Soviet Union to take off the Soviet troops. This is one thing, and this plays into, I think that this plays into the current problems we face also because it is a starting point of Germany not imagining its own size and its own weight and its own overweight in a certain sense. So Kohl here is like the symbol of this room, like who and how many kilograms he or she has. But not, and even behaving like using this weight in certain situations. But until now, we got used as a society, and particularly the political elites, of not imagining ourselves as a really important player. And this is something you can see today in this really strong, like in a slow response to the Ukrainian events, and this impossibility to react at all, like in this. Inability to lead within Europe. So I would think that there is a thing, and just to come to an end, I think that I mean that's the main reason why I accepted your invitation, because I'm really thinking of this, that German society at large did not understand even that this that German houses, German factories are built on the same ground as the fundament, which is now being crushed by Russian troops in Ukraine. We don't understand this. Like, we feel with Ukraine, we see the refugees, but we don't understand that this is taking place, let's say, on the same tectonic part of Europe, which our houses are built on. And that's something I think there's still a need to explain this impossibility. To see this very, very point that Russian bombs are destroyed.
Thank you very much. I like very much this metaphor of this tectonic one space. Of course, I'm sure that we also remember your comparison of Helmut Kohl's to elephant, which is also related to maybe Germany. That's a metaphor. Okay. And the same question goes to Małgosia, please.
Thank you, Adam, and thank you for the invitation. It's so nice and to be here, and thank you, Kinga, for hosting us here. As we have the conversation during the lunch, we see each other only on Zoom the last 2 years, so it's really nice to have this in-person conference again after the pandemic is not over, but still it's nice to be here at the Jagiellonian University. I will focus on the Polish perspective of the reunification of Germany, as I understand my task here. And I have 2 points, how it is important and why is it important for the post-war order and for the European integration. And the one point is that the history and the process of the German reunification is for me like a symbol of that you can overcome the history of your faith as a nation or as a state. And the second point is that I believe that the reunification is important, not only that it happened, I mean, it's good that it happened, but the way it happened make it also very significant for this part of Europe and for the German East, I mean, former Soviet Union relation, and which includes also German-Polish relations. Referring to the first point, to overcome the history of the faith that you is that you are as a nation or society meant to be. I will recall some numbers from 1987. It was only 4% of Poles that believed that reunification of Germany would ever happen. 4% in 1987, and it was 22% in 1999. So still very, very low number of people, of Poles, that could imagine it could happen. We know that 1 year later, it really happened. When you compare the number of the people satisfied with the German-Polish relations from the 90s, beginning of 90s, and from today, you will see how the opinion polls are rising and rising, and finding, you know, the German-Polish relations better and better, even if we have some up and downs, and even if we have some struggles and troubles on the way. I mean, in the general public opinion, the relations are very good now. I mean, about 70% of Poles believe that that the German-Polish relations are good, but it was only. It was 1990, it was only 1/3 of Poles, they were in favor of the reunification. And the people felt also threatened by the reunification. The people, the Polish people felt very, very threatened by that. And it keep going the first years of the 90s, and it changed around 1994. and that it started to be seen as a, not anymore as a threat, but as something positive, also positively impacting on the Polish situation. And nowadays we would say that the majority of Poles, they believe that the reunification of Germany also helps Poland on the way to the European Union, and it strengthen also our position. What was the main point? What was also mentioned by Basil Kerski in his keynote was, of course, the question about the border, German-Polish border. As a person who grew up in Wrocław, which used to be Breslau and Wrocław before, I can assure you that it was really a big topic. I mean, in my family, there were cases that we have visits from former inhabitants of the flats that my family was living in the 80s or beginning of 90s, and they were knocking at the door and asking if they may see and visit the places where the parents or grandparents were born, and if we allow them to visit the places. And of course, some people reacted, of course you can do it, I mean, feel free to see your former family place, but on some people the reaction was rather negative. I mean, it means that they are coming, they want to see their houses, but they are our houses. And there is a topic for another seminar about how do you feel this being Polish in Wrocław or Szczecin, and places like this, what we called po niemieckie. And it was really like a very vivid question, this. Will the Germans come back one day and want to have their homes and lands and all the goods back, which will mean for our families going back to the places that we came from to Wrocław, which was empty after the Second World War. So it was really like, I mean, I still can remember that the question of the border was, it was not only the political one, which was mentioned by Basil, the efforts of the Mazowiecki government, of Minister Skubiszewski, and this big success that they were included in this 2+4 conference, and they could raise the question about the border. They didn't succeed in having the German-Polish border treaty before the reunification. What was the aim of the Polish government at the time? It happened after the reunification, but still, I mean, it was it was a big question, and it was solved the way that we, as Poles, wanted to be solved. And the second point is what I mentioned is the way how it happened. As I used to be from my occupation and also from my heart close to the German Greens. Among the German Greens, there was a big discussion about how the unification happened. I mean, the Western Greens weren't in favor of the way how it was done. And I learned about a lot of from this perspective. I mean, I really can understand that for some of the people, it was not like reunification, was like annexation of the Eastern Germany. I mean, of course, using the word annexation today is brings us to Donbas and Lugansk and so on, and the Crimea firstly. But what I mean is like that the way how the reunification happened is makes the Germany in a schizophrenic position as an ally towards the former Soviet space. On the one hand, it makes Germany as united country, you know, the biggest ally of our countries on the way to the NATO and EU, because also of the historical experiences, but also of the responsibility that was, you know, in many speeches of the German politicians. But at the same time, the way how it happened that the former Soviet Union country as Eastern Germany became a member of the EU without all the way that we did as Poles, Czechs, Slovaks, Slovenians, and so on and so forth, makes this ally not a real ally, in my opinion. I can really feel it in the many conversation with Germans, but from both sides, I mean, from Eastern and the Western part, that there is a lack of this understanding for the path that we've been through, with all this, you know, acquis communautaire adaptation and all these efforts and the transition that was made in Poland, and the cost, what you said, Felix, were in our opinion much bigger than the cost of the former East Germany, you know, of becoming the member of the Western world. And it is, this makes this being ally of us in this part of Europe not a real ally, because of the lack of the understanding. And it's also for me also a part of the discussion that we have now of the behavior of the German government and the German society, and when you compare it with the Polish or Czech or here this part of Europe attitude towards Ukraine, I mean, you can see still the, you know, the this very different experience that coming out of the Soviet Union experience space and political influence sphere, and being part of the West, of NATO and EU. I will finish with this.
Thank you very much. So of course I'm very grateful that you brought into equation your personal perspective, what have emerged, of course, and by the way, this city, Krakow, was re-established in the 13th century, 1257, by merchants and city dwellers from Wrocław, Breslau. They were mostly German speakers. But before going to the second question, let Felix ask me, because he wanted to react or add something, please.
No, I understood that I was invited as kind of German speaker, but I have, I mean, it's not a secret, but I am actually East German. So I grew up in the eastern part of Berlin. And then, of course, I just wanted to relate to something Gosha came up with that. And that also relates to something Basil was trying to say with this modernization. I think that there's one explanation of this strange German impossibilism which we face today by getting to terms with reality and to catch up with what's actually going on in Europe. I think goes back to the lack of structural reform. And that's something what relates directly to the Polish experience, because while in Poland, every family had to cope with reality in a very direct and existential way by finding new ways of basically making it through the 90s. East German families were forced by the way situation played out to adopt basically to an existing system. So there was no search basically. I mean, there was a total crush of everything, especially of institutions and of the frame of reference. Something my parents had to face as well, and even I as a child had to face in a way, but the new frame of reference was set immediately. It was already existing. Like in 1990, the lady running the pioneer organization, she basically disappeared, and all these East German history, textbooks disappeared. They were basically put away. But then, two months later, after summer, there were coming textbooks from West Berlin, and they already represented like a different frame of reference. So thinking about large-scale German organizations, also thinking of Markus Meckel, by the way, of his problems, for instance, to coming to find his way, his place in Volkskrieger, how it's called, Kriegskrieberfürsorge. Particularly talking also to Markus Meckel, like I got this deep conviction that because reunification basically enlarged West German legislation and the way how organizations played and how society was organized, that it allowed Germany not to change for a very long time, and that it allowed in a certain way to the 80s to become a very long period. It doesn't mean that there was no reform and no change. We are not the same country, we are not the same society as in the 1880s, but some structural change is actually coming very late because of the reunification, because of the way how the east of Germany was basically attached. And I have to say that in autumn I will move on to a West German university, and it's still something relevant and non-normal to say that there's something like for me being raised in the east, that you would make your way through the institutions, as the German, as the Greens called it, and then to get this kind of success in Germany at large. And that's something strange. Also, when you look at the way how the Russian war is discussed, it is mainly West German men discussing from a very Russo-centric perspective what's going on. And I think there's a link of this and the long-term impact of the reunification.
Thank you very much, Felix. Of course, I'm not going to reveal state secrets that you also speak excellent Polish, and although you understand other Slavic or speak other Slavic languages from the region, but I appreciate it very much. And both of you, in fact, you have already mentioned this Polish-German dimension, and right now I would like to talk about the current situation. We have already met in Groningen and then in Strasbourg, and we are going to Liberec in Czechia at the beginning of June. And generally our meeting are dedicated to talk about the reunification in Germany in a wider European context, but also in a bilateral dimension, Dutch, German, French, German, Czech, German, and Polish German dimension, of course. And in that case, of course, I don't want to talk about the history, the legacy of the reunification is more than 30 years, but let's focus on the current situation. Just let me remind you, because sometimes we are not aware of the fact in Poland, and Germans are even more astonished, surprised by these numbers, but Poland, for instance, became the fifth largest trade partner of Germany, and only China, the United States, the Netherlands, a special case because that's the gate to Germany because of its geographical location, and France are that they have a bigger trade volume with Germany than Poland, and we surpassed Russia, the United Kingdom, Austria, and Italy. So it's really something impressive. Well, of course, we became a very important destination for German companies. There are very huge FDI stocks, German FDI stocks in Poland. Of course, we are part of a broader picture together with the Visegrad 4, Slovenia, Austria, Romania to a certain degree, Baltic states. That's this global value chain, which is very important for, or regionally in fact, value chain, which is very important for the German economy. So let me ask you if you share with us your evaluation where we are right now, because you have already touched upon this issue, that sometimes there are problems, tensions, that it's not so rosy, this relationship. We have ups and downs, flips and flops. So please tell me where we are right now. What is your evaluation of the current state of Polish-German relations? And maybe let's start with Małgosia, please, the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, it's a very interesting time we are now in or going through. As you mentioned, I mean, it's not surprised that the numbers of the economical exchange that you just mentioned are so high. I mean, it was invested that much money and efforts and human resources and so on in building this very strong economic ties between Poland and Germany, and it makes us also as two states more resilient when it comes to these downs in the political relations. That the economy is something very binding in this last years, especially when it comes to the relations on the society level. I mean, you will find a lot of institutions, organizations, not only those that I was working for, but there are a lot of German, Polish, or German institutions working here. Having in this 30 years a lot of also alumni, that they are, you know, as a multipliers for this German-Polish cooperation and understanding. And it is something that we should speak about very loudly, and we should be proud of it, because when we recall these numbers which I started with, I mean, it was the beginning was not that easy and not that obvious that we will reach this level of mutual understanding and cooperation. Of course, the Russian aggression in Ukraine and the way how the Poland and Germany and all other countries, be it in the bilateral or as an international organization, reacted, makes the current situation a bit complicated. I mean, you could see a lot of positive examples on the German side, also how they react and that they react so quickly. When you take it really like for German, you know, long procedures and bureaucracy and this machinery, which is German politics.
Elephant,
yeah. We should really, I mean, appreciate that the changes that they came and they are coming. But on the narrative level, on the communication level, I think that Germany is really losing in the view of many neighbors, not only Poles, and especially not only Ukrainians, because this is about them and how to help Ukrainian people fighting for our freedom and for our also democracy. But this is really a question that I'm asking myself every day, why it's so? I mean, why they do that much? I mean, the Germans, and why they cannot sell it, you know, in this way that we could understand. And because it's not happening, this narrative level, or it's happening in a very bad manner, it gives, of course, the floor, you know, for all this anti-German resentments that they are still very lively in our society, but also in other countries. I mean, they're very easy to feed, you know, and to heat them up, and even for people that they are close with Germans, and they understand why some things happen that way that they happen, it's really pity to observe how the atmosphere among Polish political and intellectual elites now is changing into rather critical, I would say, maybe not negative, but distance and critical. This is why one reason for that is also this part of this understanding and not understanding each other. I mean, this 30 years of this, you know, oh, we are now close friends and we have so many common projects together, but on the very deep level, this differences in the process of the on the German side reunification, on the Polish side the way to the structures of the Western world, we do not understand, and it is on the Polish side also. I mean, I didn't mention before that because I only concentrated on this that the Germans don't understand our way, but the knowledge about how the process of reunification and was for the East Germany is also very less known in Poland. I mean, there was recently a documentary movie on Netflix about Rohweder, a very crucial person for the East Germany transition, and it was like my husband was like, oh, I didn't know, you know, that the so many, I mean, bad things happened in the beginning of 90s in Eastern Germany because of this, you know, imagination that we had that the Germans had the easiest way and the successful way and the big brother, the big elephant with money, with Deutsche Mark, you know, and helping them out of the communist time, but we didn't pay any attention to the biographies of the Eastern German people, you know, losing the jobs, losing also the society and this tides and the structures, you know, and all this. Scouts and all the you know the organization that makes, you know, your place in the society, in the nation, in the state, and because we had this very hard way, you know, in the transition time, and we didn't pay the attention for the experience of the Eastern Germany. So and this is one example of this. What is my point that we on this very deep level, the mutual understanding is not, you know, not that that good that could be, so that we could better, you know, work together in this very critical time that we experience now. Although when you compare, I mean, what happened in the last weeks, you know, on the energy, in the energy sector with, you know, all the changes, and now Minister Habeck coming twice to Warsaw in a very short time, you know, for this connections of gas supply and so on. I mean, it was like working for a green foundation for so many years. We had, I mean, I don't know how many talks about it, and how can Germany and Poland cooperate, you know, in the energy sector. And it was so difficult. It was so difficult. I mean, everybody was trying hard, but it was so difficult. And now it's happening, you know, and it's a pity that we needed, I mean, this war to happen, that suddenly things are possible. But yeah, but they are taking place, and we should also, not take it for granted. It is based on this very long cooperation. But it could some of these things could happen before in a very, you know, peaceful and easiest way, and not in this very critical emergency module that we are now in.
Okay, thank you very much. In fact, Małgorzata provoked me to share with you that's very symptomatic. The opinion poll conducted in the middle of April in Poland, and because of the war, of course, people were asked about their attitude to different states and their expectations, if we can count on them and so on, in the case of Russia's aggression against Poland. So if Poland was attacked by Russia, could we count on the military assistance, military aid from Germany? So the response of half of Poles was negative. We can't. and almost 30% responded positively. There was a huge difference between supporters of the ruling party and the main opposition party on that particular issue. Of course, France got just a slightly better score than Germany. So unfortunately, that's the evidence of this lack of trust and confidence in the case of the Polish society. So please, Felix, what do you think about that, about the Polish-German relations, especially these days?
Well, may relate to the opinion poll, then actually I have to say that it is the truth that Germany will not help Poland because there are no tanks available. In fact, I was visiting with students Rukla in Lithuania, the rotating NATO bases, which is not rotating anymore. And actually the German...
So I'm sorry for interrupting you. You are suggesting that Poles are very familiar with the state of your armed forces.
Yes. And I mean, that's something I noticed living in Lithuania in 2014, that Lithuanians are quite aware of the number of Russian tanks in Kaliningrad. And if you would ask a German, like, he would basically not even able to... Like, Germans are not even... Until now, they only start to think about that the number of tanks available is somehow relevant to themselves. And that's, of course, something Lithuania is more aware of for obvious reasons, but also Poland, right? But the more problematic part on the German side is that, in fact, they have now, even the battalions rotating and coming to Rukla, and they are changing twice per year, they have to borrow stuff from neighboring brigades to make their way to Lithuania, you know, and this is just for symbolic reasons because the numbers are very low there. But to answer your question, I think that German-Polish relations are really in crisis. I mean, we have many indicators. There's no Polish ambassador in Berlin, if I see it right, since January. So the Polish government made sure to undiminish actually the active Polish German let's say dialogue or working communication for quite a while and earlier by sending Przyłębski a very specific type of peace politician so I see this is something I see from the Polish side, that the way how the Polish government makes sure to show the German side that they don't even dare, but at the same time blaming whatsoever is going on in Europe on the Germans, like, this is unbearable, this contradiction to me. At the same side, if we are in a Polish academic institution, I see a major crisis with the knowledge about Germany in Poland. Numbers of German speakers are historically very low. I can see the very low interest in German, maybe not in German culture at large, but at least there is a lack of professional production of knowledge about German society in Poland in general. And I think it's a bad comparison because Kaczynski is not Putin, but it is the scale of lack of knowledge in Poland about Germany is comparable to the scale of lack of knowledge in Russia about Ukraine. And this is at the source of Russian problems, really, and this miscalculation of right. And of course, if we look on the German side, I think there's a big problem again, like coming back to my idea about asymmetry and size. As Germans don't imagine themselves as nation state, they have a big problem to relate themselves to somebody who's acting like a nation state and saying the name. So we are talking about the future of the European Union. And this discussion between the tendencies towards more federalistic system and this populist right-wing response from led by Orban, Kaczynski and Le Pen. And there is a big problem that the German side is like, as it is not imagining itself as an actual nation state, what it in fact still is, there is a problem with communication. And it was, I think it was, complicated in a tricky way, as you refer to the economic strength of Poland, which is by irony a result of the very close and good relations and actual integration which is taking place, I see that the asymmetry between Germany and Poland is becoming smaller. Like for me, a good example is like DAD, this German academic exchange I was working with in Lithuania, getting used to this quite, it is a very important way of initiating exchange and let's say Verflechtung, like becoming, making things more complicated and getting people into touch, right? And I think, like for instance, I was taking care of 11 of a dozen of Belarusian scholars who had to leave Minsk in late 2020, and it was a big problem in explaining the idea that actually once the idea leaves Belarus, it should take care of these people and defend. And so on the Polish side, in the meantime, I mean not last year, but a little bit earlier, NAVA was created, like a copy of DAD, basically, having enough funds to take all of these people into. And like for me, this is just a tiny example of the Polish side being more proactive in other fields and of being able to enforce their agenda in very specific fields and maybe in a limited way. And this is something the German side is not still able really to cope with, because it is used to it is very much, the German side is still very much used to this configuration from 1990. We are having the money, we are on good terms with many Western partners, so we are actually used to dictate the terms. I myself think that urbanization of the European Union is still not from the table, and that in this context, the way how Polish the politics are organized in Poland are a threat to the European order and to the European Union beyond Poland. And I myself are arguing now, I decided that yes, the war is going on and Kaczynski is not Putin as such. And it is very important how proactive Poland reacted. And of course, Polish tanks are already in Ukraine while German parliament is still debating. That's So it took us 2 months, yes, right? I lost a little bit of my line of thoughts, but I think that it is still part of the responsibility of Germany to make sure that within the European Union there are clear terms of conduct, and that Poland, regardless of who is actually in power, should stick to this. And of course, this, we are in a very critical situation now, because it looks a little bit as if Germany is considering to send tanks, but without ammunition, to Ukraine, while I think it looks a little bit as if it is already ready to accept some of the Kaczynski, the core of Kaczynski's politics by weakening by weakening some of the democratic cores of Polish Republic. So there is a core of something what is decided now, and I decided to start advocating for German side to see that this is, that urbanization of Europe is still not from the table. And yeah.
Thank you very much, Felix. Yes, I think that regarding our knowledge about Germany, probably you are a little bit too tough, in my humble opinion. Still, definitely we are not going to invite you, don't be afraid, because of our lack of knowledge and ignorance. Nevertheless, yes, there is a problem. I agree with you that we have this image of Germany that many Poles really, they don't want understate and didn't realize that this country changed a lot, that you have, for example, people are astonished that, for example, you have a new leader of co-leader of the Grünen and these guys of Iranian background. And people are talking about his background, not about the fact that he's very much critical towards Russia and pro-Ukrainian. And that's an advantage for us. Yeah, and we should focus on that and not on his background. Thank you very much. Let me, because we have still Basil with us, and let me ask Basil maybe to jump in for a while and comment a little bit, share with us his impressions after your interventions, and we will have sort of a brainstorming, and then I will give a floor to the audience. I will open up our discussion to the audience with some comments and questions. Please, Basil.
Thank you very much for the comments. I appreciate very much the comments of Małgosia and Felix. Well, I would underline some contradiction we are facing now. It's not only Poland that is one of the biggest trade partners, but the whole Visegrad region, the four Visegrad states, are the biggest partner, economic partner of Germany, much bigger than China, much bigger than the United States. So here we see the effect of the 89 revolution, and we understand quite well, economic cooperation is also cooperation of people, building ties. This is not something by accident, it's in dynamics. And on the other side, I appreciate very much what especially Felix said. On one side, we have this reality. So Germany is today an state and a nation, a society deeply rooted in Central Europe. I would say even such investments like Elon Musk's investment of new mobilizing industry at the Polish-German border, not traditionally in the western south of Poland, shows the way of the dynamics. And on the other side, it's absolutely true. We have, I would say, a mental political crisis. The majority, even some younger politicians, didn't understand how Europe changed. And Central Europe and even Ukraine, it's not periphery. These are political, economical centers also, I would say, of new European civil society. And I would say this is a very deep crisis, but it's very easy to underline deficits, but it's much more difficult to show positive trends. One word to the deficits. I would say this German-Polish crisis is also an effect of a very active Polish policy after 2015 to underline the distance between the two nations. And on the German side, I would say a very important source of this crisis is that Germans did not understand, political allies, that also something very important happened in Central and Eastern Europe, the reconciliation, the dialogue between the Polish society and the Eastern neighbors. So European order is not only based on French, German, Polish reconciliation, it also based on a cultural, also in the field of commemoration, stabilization of Central and Eastern Europe. This is something that, yes, nobody wanted to register, to perceive, but it's a very important thing. But let us talk about positive things. I'm quite surprised, I'm very surprised that the majority of the political elites and dominating, I would say, a public opinion is now, changing, I would say, the political attitude, not only to the war in Ukraine. I'm talking to a lot of people who understood or are understanding that this, as I mentioned in my lecture, that this is not a war against the Ukraine. This is a war against, well, the idea of a democratic, open society, or a war against a democracy or in a democratic culture that is based on an open society and universal values. And well, it's true, Felix is right. We still have the problem in Central and Eastern Europe after the elections in Hungary, also after the elections in France, still nearly over 40% of French people, I would say, don't accept an open-minded, tolerant Europe, critical in distance to China and Russia. And I don't know in which direction Poland will go. Yes. So thank you, Felix, for your remarks. What strikes me in Poland is, and it makes me very angry, the Polish debate, also the Polish perception, is very concentrated on the deficits of German policy. And there is really a deficit on the symbolical level. I tried to convince German high-level German politicians in the last 4 or 5 weeks only to go to Poland and visit the refugees camps, Ukrainian refugees camps, yes, to gain legitimation in this European debate on supporting Ukraine. I was impressed by President Biden. Yes, he went to the refugee camp in Warsaw and then spoke, not only to the Polish opinion, I would say to the worldwide opinion. And it's really frustrating that even the Green ministers are really realizing such a cool, non-symbolic policy, because it really supports those powers in Poland that are investing a lot of efforts in the distance, cultural distance between Poland and Germany. Yes. So we really have a symbolic problem in Germany, although I appreciate that the German policy is radically changing. And last word, it's also interesting to observe the political, I would say, DNA of German parties. Małgosia mentioned the Green Party. It's very important to underline, on the one side, we have this West German Green tradition, people who were really interested in civic movements in Central Eastern Europe. Petra Kelly underlined that she was inspired by solidarity, that the Green Party is something like solidarity, a political movement that combines the left, right, different political sources. We have Bündnis 90, this Eastern German civic part in the Green Party today. We have this multicultural element in this party, but on the other side, we have the problem, shocking problem of the Social Democrats. You read probably the statement of Manuela Schwesing. She told, it was yesterday or 2 days ago, she told the public opinion that she's attacked by the public because she's realizing, like Willy Brandt, something positive, Deutsche Ostpolitik, reconciliation with the East. That's absurd. She didn't understand the politics in the 70s and 80s. We have the CDU, the Christian Democrats, I would say a party, unfortunately, without any ties to the whole civil society in Central and Eastern Europe. Okay, they are now in the opposition. Yes, and then Liberal Party, I would say, still connected to this idea that European politics for a long time, organized by Kinkel, by Genscher, is a core, is, I would say, a symphony of great powers, unfortunately. They also don't have any feeling for the, I would say, pluralism, not only civil society in Central and Eastern Europe. So the German policy is very, very focused on central governments, on the governing elites in Central Europe, don't investing in close ties to the society. And we see now the effects, I would say, especially in the Polish-German relations, which are, yes, I would say, in their development also limited by, yes, still this nationalistic policy of the peace covenant. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Basil, very much for your comment. And right now, of course, I'm not Putin, but let me behave a little bit like a Tsar, an absolute ruler, no checks and balances, the sky's the limit, of course. Don't be afraid. I'm going to prolong, sorry, maybe I will abuse a little bit my power, 5 minutes, maximum 7 minutes our panel, and squeeze a little bit coffee break. So please, the floor is yours, your comments, questions, everything. We have a Hyde Park right now, please.
Jokes
also, Laurynas, please, don't do that. Okay.
So first of all, thank you for the discussion. It was very interesting. You said a lot about the current situation of Polish-German relations. I would like to ask you something about the future. Małgorzata said there is that Minister Habeck was twice, if I remember, in Poland. Buddhist President Steinmeier was also in Poland last month, weeks, I'm not sure when exactly. And it shows that more and more German politicians are coming to Poland. When I watch German news, I also see that there is a lot being said about Poland because of the situation with Ukraine. And I'm afraid a bit, and that's what I would like to ask you about, what do you think about it, that German elites and German politicians started kind of accepting the urbanization of Poland? And do you think that there is still a chance for any support from the German side for democratization of Poland, that we will come back to this liberal democracy? Or it means that we lost Germans as friends fighting for our democracy as Poles here in Poland?
That's a serious question. Thank you very much. So the future and position of Germany towards the internal development in Poland.
Basil just wrote he has to leave.
Okay. Thank you very much, Basil. Again,
I have to leave. Thank you very much. Bye bye.
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 Okay, Felix or Małgosia?
Should we collect the question?
Or maybe let's start with that one. It's really serious. So, because then, sorry, I forgot. No, you will not forget. Please.
Will we get the glass ball, to predict the future? Wow, it's a tough one. I mean, it's a tough one because it's very very tricky one because as you already mentioned in the question, this is the game is about we are in Europe in this war mode and which is very serious for us, for all of us, and it in such situation there are the change of the rules allowed and you close the ice for some breaking the normal rules because you are not in normal situation, and I share with you this fear that it could happen that that maybe not only German politicians but rather generally the EU will close one eye on Polish breaking rule of law and all these processes that we've been through the last 7 years. Although now starting the rule of law procedure against Hungary yesterday makes me really more positive on this note that it's not, the fight is not given up and it will definitely, there is something going on in this respect. I can speak for and what scares me more is not even the German Polish relations and if they will close the eye on the Polish breaking the democratic rules or not, but it's like the consequences of this is are very negative for Ukraine. When we imagine the war ends one day and I believe as we are here in the room, we would like to see
Ukraine as a candidate country for the EU membership. It will make for Ukraine or Western Balkan very, very easy, difficult to get in if we have still in the EU still countries like Hungary or Poland and breaking the rule of law and so on. This is what scares me more than, you know, the direct impact on the German-Polish relations, because it will, yeah, it will close, you know, the door for the others, and it will be very, I mean, very pity when you see for to the future of the European Union. And what will be, how will be the relation, German-Polish relation in the future? Depends very much on the Polish side, you know, on the next elections that we are heading, and nobody knows when they will happen. Because I can still see the, you know, the interest of German politicians, you know, in having here good relations, not only because of the economy. And I see also this crisis and this we as the West were stupid or have a blind eye on the what was happening here in the eastern part of Europe, and we should have been listened to our friends in Poland, Czech Republic, and so on and so on. It's as a window of opportunity, you know, to renew the way how we talk with each other and how we design the European Union policy together. So I'm still optimistic on this note, but the results of the next Polish election will be here for sure.
Thanks. What would you add?
As a historian, I would say that everything will change. And that it is
sooner or later.
And it is not, and it is not clear that in 1,000 years Poland and Germany will still exist as states, because we know that states are temporary constructions. But to be honest, I think that we should.
China will disagree.
Sorry for making this reference to Putin again, but as the way how Putin is playing out the war is actually not a sign of strength, but of a deep crisis of Russia and of Russian elites and of the Russian state and of the Russian economy. Something what actually relates today to the situation in 1990 and in 1980s in Poland, yeah, you know, that you have an economic crisis becoming a state crisis and vice versa. Mm-hmm. And then is the question how to get out of this. Yes. Mm-hmm. So in 1980 and in 1990, basically West Germany paid a lot of money to get out of this in an economic way. And then there were some political, and we know that this will not be the solution right now, but the link with Putin for me is, and Kaczynski and Scholz, is that they are representing very much, they are representing the past, and they are in the sense that they are presenting a certain way of male, they are actually presenting the crisis of a male politician in his middle ages. So we have this Twitter joke to be allowed to have a bad Twitter joke transferred to you like that. Actually, Annalena Baerbock is doing a quite good job as a chancellor. You know? So because she's behaving as a chancellor, and one part of the answer why she's doing is that because she is a woman and she's representing a different style of understanding and doing politics. And I'm not betting now that actually. Like, I'm not saying that in Poland and in Germany there will be earlier elections and that Annalena Baerbock will actually come back into politics in a different role. What might happen, as this might still happen in Poland, that you will have earlier elections. And, but I think that the game is actually open. For sure is, like what I know for sure, not as a historian, but as a, like, as a contemporary, SPD, CDU, Die Linke, they are in deep crisis. Because they are actually about to lose the basis of their electorate, and there's a big question about the future of our societies, because the way how parties used to address social groups at large is not working anymore. So, and this is something which is common to all of these societies, including Russia, in a strange, undemocratic way, that actually this, we are in dynamic times, not because the front line is changing in Ukraine, what is also the case, but because our societies are changing. So there will be for sure, this will have an impact on German-Polish relations. And to finish is that I think that changes, the future will start from sending, you know, Marek Cichocki or somebody who at least, you know, to send somebody to Berlin who's able to talk to German elite without blaming it for everything, you know.
Thank you very much. We have to finish or the last short question. Yes, Kinga, we can?
Yeah.
Please. So, the last short question. Really short. Sorry, because we have already passed. Yeah.
The ambassador sent it from the Polish side to Germany. Is not present there, and can you elaborate more on that and speak? Because this is something is a spur of my interest. And
it's a strange. Yeah. I mean, it's a really strange story that the Germans sent an ambassador to Poland, who is the son of somebody who was present in Hitler's bunker during the last days of the war, which is kind of also a strange sign of not understanding Polish politics, because then the Polish side let him wait for a couple of months actually before allowing him to enter the country. And then, but the Polish part is also strange. That, Because in the, I mean, to put it very short, Poland sent to Berlin not only the husband of the head of the Polish so-called constitutional tribunal, which actually at the heart of the constitutional crisis we have in this country, but he was also an official member of the state security service, which is quite known, and you can go to IPPN and he's still in the record. So. As he was the husband of the head of the constitutional court, he was in a quite strong position from the point of view of peace government. But he did a lot of harm to German-Polish relations by basically, mainly doing bold statements and beyond this, not really doing diplomatic work. And so, what is even more strange is that after him, there's nobody. What is kind of a is this basically saying Germany, go and fuck yourself, you know? I mean, this. Sorry.
Part of the Russian warfare.
Yeah. Okay, sorry for being so emotional.
Excellent. Thank you very much. It was really great to moderate this panel. I hope that you enjoy it with me. And let's join me. Meeting after the coffee break, 15 past 4.
Kto zaczyna?
Ja zaczynam.
Okay.
Dzień dobry ponownie.
English, please.
I'm evacuating all those languages at the same time. Hello once again after the coffee break. I hope you had a short rest and now we can move into the human dimension. I think the first talk we had with Felix and Małgosia was more focused on the global perspective. I think Basil, in a sense, gave a feel of, you know, how what's happening now is actually a global fight for democracy. Now we probably will try to sort of go a level down and look at the at the level of migration, because when Ivona and Kinga were conceptualizing this meeting here in Krakow, they really wanted to focus on migration, because they thought that this human dimension of them, especially the 1989, September, October, the huge flight of East Germans sort of across Eastern Europe back into Germany was something very instrumental, something that we don't really talk about, and something of a real emotional load that somehow got sort of pushed out from our collective memory, especially, you know, in these countries like Hungary and Poland. So this was the topic, and then what we've witnessed over the past 2 months is something that we see very close by again: this totalitarian system, authoritarian, let's call it authoritarian for now. The Russian attack also. Okay, let's call it fascist, but it's okay, it's authoritarian, causing another massive wave of migrations. And maybe it's in a way of sort of, again, connecting these two elements into one and talking about empathy as a very important aspect of German reunification that we forgot. So I'm very happy to welcome at our panel Dr. Maciej, Stępka from the University, Jagiellonian University, Cornelius from the Polish-German Polish-German Foundation, Polish Cooperation, and all those languages. And Ivona Reichert from the College of Eastern Europe and New Eastern Europe, here our host. Maybe I'll give the floor first to Maciej, who will have a short introduction to the topic, more on the history, as I understand, and then we move on to a discussion. Very welcome to contribute, and then everyone else is very welcome to join with questions and remarks.
Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me to this fun. It's a great honor to open this and give some opening introductory remarks. I come from security studies, and I study EU migration and border policies, and it's quite difficult to talk about migration and EU policies without Germany, of course. Not only about Germany, but Germany certainly and its policies play a very important role. So first, when I was invited to speak here, I was told not to be very academic, so I'm full panic mode. And yes, exactly. So I wrote my paper and then made it less academic, and you know, it took 5 minutes to just introduce it. So forgive me if it's too general, and forgive me if it's too precise and too academic. I try to make it as broad as possible. So of course the topic is very complex: Poland, Germany, unification, migration. So we can talk for hours about it, of course, but we still learn how to talk about migration in Europe, and not only Europe. Migration is something that we have in our DNA as human beings, but still migration, migrants are something alien to us. So let me just briefly talk about main features and significance of migration, then move to discussing reunification and of Germany and how migration in Germany happened after the reunification, and how it then translates to ongoing discussion about EU migration policies and border policies, because in my mind, these are two extremely connected: mobility and immobility, something that allow us to engage migration and engage mobility in something that creates these technical obstacles that we are so fond of nowadays, right? We deal with so-called fetishization of borders and fetishization of walls that we erect. Donald Trump started this great phenomenon talking about walls, and not far from here, maybe not that far, but in the Polish-Belarusian border, we erect new borders by glorifying destroying other ones, destroying the Berlin Wall. So let me begin after this very lengthy introduction. Change generates human mobility. Mobility generates change, be it socio-political, economic, farming, hunting grounds, social, economic betterment, education and employment, something that is very close to Polish people and also German people who engage mobility after the fall of the Berlin Wall. German people marched basically west in number of 1,400,000 after the fall of Berlin Wall, creating one of the greatest movements back in the day on such a small area. We migrate to survive, we migrate to grow and develop as human beings and communities. The flow of people sustains circulation of knowledge, culture, resources, including money, and sustains broadly understood development of human beings. That's why human dimension is so important. And states, after all, freedom of movement is one of the founding freedoms that we have in the European Union. We cherish it so much. And it's one of the key elements of European, so-called European prosperity. And of course, migration is good, right? But first of all, migration should not be alien to us as we have it, as it is so close to our survival, and it's so crucial to our survival. It's difficult to talk about migration without borders and the meaning of borders and walls and all these technologies of containment and control of human mobility. So it is quite interesting to talk about this, especially when it comes to reunification, and one of the greatest symbols of these times, the Berlin Wall. I was preparing for this so obvious to you as researchers German relations that on this day of the fall of the Berlin Wall, on the 9th of November, around 9 p.m., as many historical sources say, the act of mobility, the act of crossing borders, was one of the most important acts of freedom back in the day. People managed to cross border from one side of Berlin to another without being killed. And it was something extremely crucial for reunification of Germany, but also for mobility. Migration is not just migration from one country to another country. I do not like using the word migration, which is so politically charged. Mobility is something that is much more positive. And this ability of mobility was this pronunciation and the proof of freedom of German people. Walls never work as we design them to work. Give me a high wall, I will give you even a higher ladder. So this was something, this was the truth that was realized back in the day, the 1990s, during the German reunification. This is something that we forgot. They are creeping back to our imagination, our collective imagination, but something that actually works. And again, Polish-Belarusian border is one of the greatest examples that not only Poles, but also Europeans and EU leaders go back to this concept of building walls as something that can work, something that can stop and manage this basic human instinct that is migration. Well, it cannot. The migration, the so-called migration crisis of 2015 and 16 showed us that, no, we cannot manage migration, really. Germany played a very important role, allowing us to diffuse this crisis, but also Poland right now shares this history really with Germany, allowing or helping to diffuse the current also refugee crisis, and maybe not Poland, Polish people, Polish society helps to diffuse this specific problem. It's something that we have to and we should understand. So change generates mobility, and the mobility also generates social change. So these two elements are very closely intertwined. So of course, the fall of the Berlin Wall and reunification of Germany changed the landscape of migration for Germany. And let me just give you a couple of very basic statistics that really show us that history likes to repeat itself. When it comes to Polish emigration to Germany, of course, in 1990, it spiked a little bit, but it grew because, suddenly this oppressive regime built around walls was destroyed, was removed, these obstacles were removed. But then it's kind of declined, the dynamics, still growing dynamics declined when Poles were starting to look for new opportunities for economic development. So mobility has changed a little bit, doesn't change the fact that in 1990, Germany had around 240,000 Poles in its territories. Right now, we have around 860,000 Poles living in Germany. I already mentioned that it was this great march from east to west, with, of course, different reasons, family reunification being one of very important reasons why so many people decided to engage mobility from east to west, but also, of course, economic opportunities. Only 100,000 people decided to march from east to west. So East Germany, in terms of migration demographic distribution, had this deficit of people for a very, very long time, actually till 2014. In 2014, this changed. And suddenly there was a surplus of people of this exchange between East and West. Why? Because people started to return. So we had these returnees who gained capital, experiences, et cetera, et cetera, and decided to retire, for example, in East Germany or in this part of country. And actually, right now, it is still a thing. I mean, the surplus is still on a plus. Another very important thing from the point of migration is the resettlers, or the topic of resettlers. 1.4 million native Germans moved from former Soviet territories back to Germany, adding to this migratory perfect storm in Germany. They were not called Auslanders, they were called Aussiedler, right? So resettlers. I do not speak German very well, so sorry for my pronunciation. And it happened, the main influx of these resettlers happened from 1989 to 1993. And to add to this, we had another very important geostrategic and geopolitical situation, Yugoslavian war, which contributed to the wave of asylum seekers in Germany. In 1992, Germany recorded 438,000 applications. We have to remember that in 2015, when the European Union announced the state of migratory crisis, the beginning of the migration crisis in the European Union, 2015, Germany recorded 476,000. So it was not much more than in 1992. So this all translated into a very complex migratory situation. We had reunification of Germany, economic problems, very high unemployment, the problem of merging, something that Poles can relate to, merging two systems, right? Merging two systems, two mindsets, two frames of reference, two ways of political thinking, plus this migratory perfect storm. I would love to tell you that Germany has solved this problem and everyone lived happily ever after. But this is, they haven't. Something that I just described, this migratory situation, really can be compared to what we have right now, increasing levels of asylum seekers, increasing levels of migratory movements, also internal problems, something that we do not talk enough, I think, in terms of Germany, that in 1990s, Germany was extremely confused when it comes to its future, but also when it comes to its approach to foreigners. There were massive, between 1990 and 1993, 49 people were killed as an act of violence in the streets of German cities, mostly Turks. There was violence and far-right resentments, which showed back in the day. People were writing to the government saying that it's an apocalypse and something has to be done. There has to be harsher law introduced. I think that this resentment unfortunately carries on and till today, and we are still trying to figure out how this story will unfold. And we also are trying to figure out how to address these very complex migratory situations. We are stuck between this fetish of security and walls and this openness, inclusiveness, and pro-migrant policies. And we really do not know what to do as a community, as nation states, even as societies. I think that so this is like a very general picture, and again, sorry if you heard it many times before, but I think it gives like a nice introduction to something that we'll be talking about, the human dimension of these processes and dynamics will be introduced by our esteemed guests. So I yield the floor and thank you very much for your attention. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Maciek. I think we'll come back to some of the things that you mentioned are really interesting. I mean, when you think about it, yes, we talk about the Berlin Wall as this fundamental barrier, and human movement as a symbol of the Cold War. And now we, as the democratic side, have built are building a huge wall between ourselves and Lithuania, Poland, and Belarus. On the other hand, I think even the Ukrainians would be happy with a wall north to Belarus and maybe north to Russia in a way. So we have actually shifted sides, and we, as the democratic side, think of having a wall as something very fairly positive. And that's one thing. And the other thing I think I'll later ask, maybe as a second or third question, I'll ask Cornelius about this migration of German people from German background into Germany and the meaning for it now. But to begin with, maybe just as a little warm up, with your reflection, and the 90s, on the one hand, the Germans reuniting and moving to Western Germany and moving through Poland, that's one thing. And the other thing is, how do you remember and how do you reflect on the movement of Poles into Germany after the fall of the communist states? So maybe if we can begin, I'll ask Cornelius just to say a few words from your perspective, general reflections on the 89 and the migratory movements then.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah, okay. Good. No problem. Let me start with a story from 89. I have been working at the University of Mainz as a student in a group of people by Professor Weidenfeld, who was at the time advisor of Chancellor Kohl for European Affairs. And the seminar took place on Tuesday, and Weidenfeld went with Helmut Kohl to Warsaw. So his assistant, unprepared, came to the room, and it was a seminar about the German relations, about the relations between the Federal Republic of Germany and DDR. And the assistant didn't know what can he do and asked us, what do you think? Do you think in your life there is a chance for reunification? And about 30 people, and few people put the finger, I don't know, 7, 8, maybe 10, but the majority, 2/3 of people, of students dealing with German relations at 2 days before the Berlin Wall broke down, didn't thought about this possibility. And it wasn't people on the street, it was students who, after 3-4 years of studies, decide to write the master about German politics, German relations. So you see that it was a Tuesday, and a Thursday in the evening, in the night, the Berlin Wall broke down. And it was a shock, not only for the German political elite, it was a shock for everyone, every student, every child. And nobody knows at this time what will happen. And me personally, I went on this Thursday to London. And I didn't know that the war broke down, you know. It was a big chance. Yeah. I have never been in London, and it was a chance for 99 Deutsche Mark to go to London. We went by bus from Frankfurt to Zeebrugge, by the ferry in the night to London. We spent a day in London. We came back via Netherlands, and nobody discussed it. Nobody knows about the Berlin Wall. And we crossed the Belgian-German border by bus, and I went to filling station, I decided to buy a newspaper. There was no newspaper. And I went out, what's happened? And I found an old Bild-Zeitung on the floor, and there were people sitting on the Berlin Wall. Yeah? And I took this newspaper and I brought it to the bus. And I go, hey, guys, what? The Berlin Wall broken down. And the people was laughing. Yeah? Nobody realized what does it mean. Yeah? And the months after this important this decision, or it influenced the world policy, and the people focused on the home problems. A lot of people in Mainz, in Western Germany, we have had at the university, I think not more than 100 young students coming from Germany, from East Germany. And it was a big discussion. What does it mean? Could we integrate? We have two guys in the political sciences. No? So and we discussed hours with them. What does it mean? And nobody thought that in few months there could be, or there is a possibility of reunification. No? The young people thought about neutral Germany, unified but neutral Germany, not member of NATO or something else. The young generation, and you know, at the university, oh, Mainz University was a very, very conservative university. The University of Mainz was the only one university in Germany with LCDS, with a movement of Christian conservative students who controlled the students' parliament. In every other university, it was left-oriented, and Mainz was only one university in Germany with such a conservative students. And a big discussion about further development. You know, it was a Gorby time in Germany, hundreds of students learning Russians because Gorbachev, a friend of Germany, and so on. So at this time, it was a feeling that two German states will exist together as a neutral state in the center of Europe. It was at this time a dominating idea of the young people. Of course, it's changed a few months with a hundred for students, it was a big problem at this time, because a lot of people from Eastern Germany came to the West, and it was difficult to get a cheap flat. It's the same situation as today in Poland. Yeah, and I now, because at this time, after 2 years in a student home at the university, I was looking for a flat, and it was a kind of competition between students and people coming from Eastern Germany. So it were our problems and not a big policy. Maybe at the beginning.
To begin with all the complaints about all those Eastern Germans flooding.
Auschwitz, yeah.
Ivana, how do you remember? Maybe play the Polish role.
With a German last name. But yes, I do not have German blood, despite the last name. I have a husband with a German blood. But because I'm asked to present a Polish perspective. So of the moment of, let's say, the reunification. Polish. So before the reunification, Polish people, when I was thinking about this question, I thought to myself, how did we know Germans? So we had two German states, so we knew two different types of Germans, or two Germanies, yes. We knew Western Germany, I mean, the knowledge was very limited too, but mostly in human terms, through Polish people who emigrated for political and economic reasons from Poland to Germany. These were usually our contacts in Western Germany. In Eastern Germany, because there were very few contacts, human contacts between Western Germany and the Polish communist state in terms of professional exchange, etc. Some existed, yeah, but not on a scale like we have today. Our knowledge of Eastern Germany was more professional, let's call it this way. Yes, there were different associations, communist style, everything, yes, between Eastern Germany and Polish communist structures, institutions. So these were our contacts. That's how our contacts and our knowledge about these two German states from other human beings was generated. And my family was exactly the same. We knew people who escaped from Poland, especially in 1980, because in Poland the martial law was introduced and they escaped to Western Germany. These were family members and these were friends of my parents. And in Eastern Germany, we happened to have close friends as well. My mom met once on a train as a student, a lady who later became her close friend, but she was East German, quite high up, and a good friend, a very friendly person. So this was our knowledge, yes, sort of formal German state or through formal institutions in East Germany, and much more informal knowledge about the functioning of West Germany. And why I'm saying this, it will also matter later, but for my family, it had a direct impact because I was in Germany, in East Germany, of course, 1990, in Berlin, Eastern Berlin. And that was the moment, it was in August, when Polish people could probably remember this, enter the West Berlin for one day.
Buy food.
Oh, food, exactly. Yeah. So this is also part of my story. So we visited our East German friends and official East Germans, you know, working in Berlin. They were very unhappy that we had to go, but my parents said, we cannot miss the opportunity. Ivona has to see West Berlin, even though I was little. And so we left our Skoda in East Berlin. My dad said, look, this is the wall. He showed me the wall from the eastern side. Then we crossed, indeed. Was this Czechoslovakian?
No. For Polish, it was Friedrichstrasse.
Okay, so we crossed the crossing on foot, and on the western side, of course, the Polish emigrants from the 1980 were waiting for us and showed us all the beauty of capitalism, things that we couldn't afford, you know, wonderful ice cream. I'll never forget these things. And so coming back, as the wall, the most important, because I come from a family of sociologists and sociologists of politics. So my father, of course, had to show me. He said, look, Ivana, this is the Berlin Wall from the western side. So I had these two images, you know, coming back. So yes, around 8 o'clock, we had to say goodbye. And we came back, yes, to the reality that was more known to me. And I will never forget this, because when the wall fell, I really like seeing it on two sides. It's really two dimensional. It changes your perception so much. So this was, but I felt I was the lucky one. I don't think many people in Poland did have this. But this also shows a little bit our image of Germany. I think the image I had of Germans on both sides was the image of Germany after the reunification, and of what Germany would be and what Poland wanted to be and not wanted to be. So I think the what I saw in Western Germany was like sort of embodiment of all my dreams, my images from before, because in Poland, even though we were living under communists, there was a black market, and the German culture reached us through products, some films. So definitely through culture, yes, but also through products. So when the reunification took place and systems started changing everywhere throughout Europe, Polish people, I believe that we associated in a great majority the West with Western Germany. Yeah, and that was the cars. So not surprisingly, my father bought an old Opel. Yes, and he was not the only one. So it had to be the German car. Young girls were using German cosmetics because this was something we were seeing in girls' magazines from West Germany that we were buying sometimes in the black market. Later, they came to Poland. So this, in materialistic terms, Western Germany for us was an embodiment of an impression and image of the West, yes? And something what we at that time, I think, wanted to have and wanted to be. West German tourists was also something we somehow admired. Have a good camera, yes? And that was also our dream. But I think the same image was in Eastern Germany for Eastern Germans. But there was also what Małgosia already said, there was a fear that definitely existed too, maybe in different groups than had the dream, but in parts of Poland where Germans owned property, this was a legitimate fear. And I know it from Silesia, to where my mom's family comes from. People were simply afraid that somebody will come and take over the apartment, the house, and all these things that before belonged to other people, and they felt that maybe they didn't fully 100% belong to them, but they now live there and it's in some way theirs. And of course, history, yes, learning history under communism. I can say that it was very heavily ideologized, under heavy influence of ideology. Of course, a huge communist interpretation, yes, pro-Soviet Union, etc., but also extremely anti-German in terms of course, interpretation of World War II. And this was very natural to us. So when we had to relearn to talk about history in a little bit different terms, for example, maybe start thinking not only saying German camps, yes, concentration camps, but Nazi, to use the term Nazi, it was new to us. And I think right now the Polish current nationalistically minded politicians exploit that this was a wrong process to forget about the German element in these terms. But at that time to learn this, that it's not only German, but to use the word Nazi was something new and something we had to relearn. And I don't think it was easy for some people. So this is my memory of the early days. But
I could add a few words, my experience, because I have total different experience because of my development. I was born in Poland, in Silesia, and we have had family in West Germany and in East Germany. So I traveled as a child several times to West Berlin, but because the grandma was in West Berlin. And I remember Friedrichstrasse, East German border police with big dogs and so on, controlling everything and so on, but a different picture in West Berlin. Mm-hmm. On the other side, we have had a family in Eastern Germany near to Görlitz, interesting story, in Ostritz, as you see the map, there is a railway from Görlitz to Zittau. And the railway is going on the both sides of the border. And Ostritz has had a railway station in the past. It was Ostritz Ost on the other side. And in the 70s, when GDR and the Polish Communist government signed a cooperation agreement, they opened a railway station on the Polish side. So the people living in Ostritz could go to the train crossing the border. It was a special bridge. But you can see, for example, how difficult the Polish side named this railway station, not Ostritz Ost, no? Skwierzyna z Gorzelecka. A special name to show the instruments. It's not your station, yeah? You know, you never will spell this name. So I traveled to the East Germany to several times because it was a brother of my mother who 45 went from Silesia to Austria. Interesting story. Few years ago, my cousin realized and found out that his father, as a not a police station but fire station, boss of fire station for 20 years, was an unofficial cooperated guy from Stasi. And 30 years after the reunification, you have the opportunity to check it what your parents, grandparents did in the GDR time. So when I in the 80s in West Germany, so in 89, I was prepared a little bit more than other people for guys from Eastern Germany, and I could follow the arguments about politics, this deep based wish of freedom, because the propaganda was so deep that a reunification of Germany for a lot of the people, it was neutrality. And this you used term as your Russians and your Americans, as Russians or Soviets in the GDR control everything. Mm-hmm. And in Mainz, in this time, we have had in Mainz in the 80s three American barracks, with American tanks and so on, and people coming from GDR told us, Germany is not an independent state. Look, here are the American tanks. There is on the other side of the city, there are American helicopters. Let put them out, Soviet home, American homes, and let organize a new German. I don't know if Felix can, with your experience, if you could support my idea. It was the end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s. It was my experience with young people, students from East Germany who came to Mainz.
Well, from
Stempka,
I think German perspective, it was totally different.
Okay, we'll bring Felix later on, but maybe coming back to Poland and Germany, I think maybe just again mentioning Felix and Małgosia, who tried to be positive but ended fairly on a neutral to a negative note, how you know there is less contact received in the academic sense and so on between Poland and Germany now, how we have these political discussions and disagreements. Let's be very open and frank about it. But what's your take on the meaning of migration? You know, the 1990s could have been like a golden age for Polish, up to 2010, maybe 2015. It was lots of migration, lots of movement, mobility rather than moving migration, coming back, coming and going, you know, the intensity of contacts. How do you think, when we look now, maybe we could think, oh, maybe it didn't really work out. Do you think it worked out, and how strong are the foundations laid by the 25 years or so of intense mobility between Poland and Germany? How much good did it do to Germany, to Poland, and to the European Union? Any one of you? Maybe it didn't work out. Why did we migrate?
Let's few words about German perception of
migration, not only from Poland, but from Central Europe in the 90s. In my eyes, the German elites focused on reunification of Germany at the beginning of the 90s. A lot of problems, not only with people from Eastern Germany coming to the West asking for jobs or for flats, but problems in Eastern Germany with the whole industry system, transformation of economy, millions of unemployment, at few, and people coming from Eastern Europe, not as a tourist, but as a labor force, you know. For example, in Mainz, a lot of people from Poland coming for the agriculture, winery, and so on. So on the one hand, it was a big advantage for the shadow economy. On the other side, differences or competition between people from Eastern Germany and Eastern Europe. That's the end. Oh, in my eyes, the situation changed. The German elite realized that Central Europe, it is not only a cheap labor force. There are not only young people coming to work, but it could be in security question. Central Europe could be a partner. It was, in my eyes, the first change at the end of the night. And in the meantime, it was the Balkan Wars. Mm-hmm. The Balkan Wars with 400,000 to 500,000 migrants. It was a big problem. It was a problem not for the German. In a different terms, you know, it minds what it was in this time a city dominated by Croats, because Mainz and Zagreb, they are partner cities, and a lot of restaurants who changed the name from Yugoslav restaurant to Croatian restaurant. You know, on the other side, Frankfurt, 30-40 kilometers, dominated by Serb migration and conflict between them. Really, really strong country with explosions and fires in the night and so on. So it was a topic for the German society, not Central Europe and so on. Balkan War was a big problem, and hundreds of thousands of people who stayed in Germany, who are today German citizens, living in Germany for 5 years and so on. So I don't, the German society is a society of migrants. After the Second World War, 10 million people, of course, ethnic Germans, but not accepted by the population in Germany. Yeah, you can read a lot of books about the problems with integration. Uwe Rada is one of the guys who wrote about migration from to the north of Germany and so on. The migrants, the Czech, Sudetendeutsche, with problems in the 50s. Not accepted in Bavaria, yeah. And after the migrations wave to Germany, 56, Budapest, Prague, and so on. So the German society had to accept migrants the whole time, Yugoslavian wars and so on. And last but not least, million people a few years ago. So, and differences, of course, between Western Germany, the society who had to integrate people, Italian Turks and so on. I have had in mind since this time, in the house I lived, Turks, Italians, and mentioned, I don't know who mentioned it, the so-called Russlanddeutsche, more than 1.5 million people in the 90s. And please realize that the words Russlanddeutsche used in for the migrants with the German origin from the former Soviet Union, but Deutsch-Türke. The Russlanddeutsche people from the former Soviet Union accepted as a German, Russian German, but the Turks are not Germans. They are German Turks. So you see on this example how different could be the exception or integration accepted in Germany.
I'll go to maybe Maciej or Ivona, because that's the German perspective. You know, you drew this picture that Germany is a migratory country of migrants. Lots of people have migrated. I think, as much as I know Poland and I've been observing it, I think for Poland, migration to Germany has had a much more significant meaning. You know, the 90s and the 2000s, you know, Polish people moving to Germany and socializing in Germany through work, through academic contacts, and so on. How do you think, how much has it had an influence on the Polish society that we have today, this migration after 1989 from Poland to Germany, and then maybe coming back or just having stronger relations with Germany?
I can conclude.
Okay. Well, as we talked about this fear of, for example, property, yes, losing property. I have family in contingent Poland. So Silesia region where there was, which was part of Germany before as well, and where there's a lot of German property. So that fear in my grandparents' circles was of course present as well. But what happened with the migration, people discovered that actually property is empty and Polish people don't live there. So not only Germans didn't come to take it back, but Polish people left to Germany. But they left to Germany white. They went to Germany to work because Kędzierzyn Koźle was a small town, heavily dependent on industry. We had an economic, serious economic crisis in the 1990s, clearly transferring from planned economy to capitalism. A lot of people lost jobs, so massively they moved where? To Germany, naturally. Mostly western parts of Germany, and houses were empty and the city looked spooky. I remembered as a child that it was a lively city with ice cream places, you know, happy places. And then when I was coming to visit my grandparents, the market, the main market, was sometimes even scary, especially in the evening. So so that was the direct effect, yes. Who stayed? Usually women with children. Fathers were the first one who left. So we had these households without men. When I now think about Ukrainian migrants, I often have this thought too, that this resembles, this reminds me of this situation back in the 90s. But yes, for some people, migration to Germany was a dream. As I said before, West Germany was associated with the West overall. So they would move to Germany for economic reasons, hoping to become like West Germans. And of course, we know that they didn't. Yes, it's very difficult to become West German when you just arrived with nothing from a communist, post-communist Poland. So with this came disappointments, yes, reality check, as we say in English. So nowadays but at the time, I think we believed that capitalism, democracy is something so positive that associated, of course, with the West, that you will naturally absorb it. That means happiness. So you move to a democratic, capitalistic country, you become tolerant, democratic, etc. Well, we learned from our Polish elections in 2015 that migrants not necessarily vote for democratic forces, that actually they like the social benefits that are available in the West. They were not available, for example, in Poland. But maybe they did not like the cosmopolitan culture, the multiculturalism. I think this is how we verified our assumption that being a migrant is not always adjusting to this Western cultural model, but sometimes it's you also become bitter because you kind of you failed or you didn't achieve what you thought you would achieve, and it's very difficult to be a migrant, and it's very difficult to achieve the level of people who have been living there for generations. So this frustration is expected, and but it's at the individual level it's very difficult to sometimes absorb. So and not always the experience of living in Western or in Germany was positive for society. Yeah, for political reasons too.
Yes. So I will repeat that at least for me the element of mobility is how we survive. Right. So and develop. So of course, Polish people, the element of migration to Germany, to especially Western Germany, was a matter of survival and development. And of course, Poland is a nation in culture of immigration. Right. So we engage migration in order to survive and also gain money. And we still, even till today, we benefit greatly as an economy, Polish economy, from these revenues that come from our so-called Polonia, right? All the Polish Polish immigrants. What is quite interesting when it comes to Germany, which is this mythical destination, Polish people, even I paid for my first laptop with German euros. So for me, the seasonal work that you talked about was important. Now, I was born in 1985, so it's kind of blurry. It's very blurry for me, but I still have like flashes of some things that happened back then. But even for me, it was a thing to go to Germany and earn money and buy something that I could not afford in Poland. Even though I was not educated in communist country, etc., this stayed in the culture of immigration, silent immigration. I don't know if today's youth thinks the same. I hope that you can afford your laptop without working in a strawberry field or any other field. But the thing is that it stayed with us even with this later generation. But Poles are quite pragmatic when it comes to immigration, and we, after the accession to the European Union, President Poles, of course, changed the direction of immigration to countries that did not protect their economies and labor markets. And Germany was one of these countries. So the UK opened, and suddenly the wave of Polish immigrants just moved there and still are there, while immigration to Germany dropped and quite significantly. So of course it is the mythical destination for Poland, and it's still very important, but it changes, of course it changes the dynamics, it changes. So one more thing that I would like to add, and with this perfect storm that happened back in the 1990s, we do not include this element that Schengen was being introduced in 1990, the Schengen Convention, right? So even the element of Schengen, which is still very problematic from security point of view and migration, was present back then. Plus, reunification was this soft accession, right? The European communities back then allowed this huge territories to the community without really accession talks. So it was a very strange thing for the European community to do. Migration of from east to west when it comes to Germans. I still think it was beneficial for, especially for East Germany, the circulation of knowledge and capital, et cetera, et cetera. But also I think that it allowed for Westernization and Europeanization, however defined, of East German people, which was extremely, extremely important. They had to learn and see and touch colors, and which were not present in communist countries, right? Everything was gray. And this reality that was soon to be their reality. So this element of familiarity that concept of migration was very important, and it still is for Poles and every single country that is being Europeanized. That the fact that we go somewhere and learn something and come back and try to transfer this knowledge, know-how, etc., etc. I think that it's more and more common. You know, the Erasmus, for example. I started to talk to my first serious discussion about Polish-German relations was in Belgium with a German student. I was really afraid to talk to this person because it was East German student. And I haven't noticed any difference between East and West. It was German, but for him it was important. It was really striking because we do not learn about this, and this is something that was told before, that we do not know Germany the way we should. So of course it was kind of tense because, you know, your grandfather stole something from etc. You know, this whole situation that we have. But suddenly we realized that we have a lot in common because, you know, the fact that he was from East Germany mattered in a sense of this post-communist heritage. You know, yeah. he lived in a post-communist country, really, and I also had grown in a post-communist country, so we had a lot of commonalities that I didn't realize, and it was so educational, and I was so mad that I had to wait till I was 23 or 22, I don't remember, to have this very important conversation. And Erasmus and the European Union and European integration allowed me to have this specific experience. Without that, it would not be possible. So for me, it was very important. Yeah, so.
I think our leader will control the time in a good way. But there's a short moment to ask some questions before we wrap up and give the floor to the students to present the poster. Does anyone have a question? Would anyone like to ask a question?
A short film?
We still have a short film.
Yeah. 3 minutes.
3 minutes. Okay. So we'll allow for the film. I wanted to make a footnote to this by asking, you know, the reception of the current refugee flow. On the one hand, the Poles that are stressing, you know, how much they have experienced moving out, and you know that's why they have to be also helpful to the help the Ukrainians moving. I think even in our research that we did with Ivan a few years ago on the Polish-Ukrainian relations, you know, this experience of migration and migration to the West has also shaped Polish attitudes towards people moving, migrating, obviously to people of the white race rather than any other race, but there's been a sort of an important socializing factor with maybe what Cornelius just said about, you know, Germans so used to these waves of migrations, maybe this makes Germany a bit more I would not say callous, but maybe a bit more
desensitized
by these flows of migration, because it's a very empathic society that keeps on taking people, but that it doesn't really have the groundbreaking experience that it's had for the Polish state. So should we go with the film now?
Yeah, maybe Cornelius will say a few words, because that's the Polish-German condition. About the historical fact, because not many people know it. I'm sure for students.
We only financed this film
okay.
As 100 other projects.
Okay.
Yeah.
But that's okay. So
say a few words first.
Yeah. If you could say, and it starts like a minute three, check 3:30.
So said that. Is this?
This is allowed. Yes. CDA is allowed. Yes. They show it in Polish schools.
At the
university it's allowed.
Okay.
Well, so otherwise I have a CD. Do you have a
CD player? But maybe
museum.
Maybe Cornelius could say a few words about the film.
What happened? Like what the film's about.
It's a film about refugees from GDR who came via, who left GDR via Warsaw to the West in days before the war broke down. Every one knows about the GDR people in Prague or in Budapest, but at the same time, about 6,000 to 7,000 people went to Warsaw, spent few weeks in the embassy in Warsaw, and after that in a special places near to Warsaw. And at the same time, when the trains from Prague and Budapest went to Germany, a special trains from Warsaw went to West Germany via GDR.
So this is to show you that Polish experience is not only immigration to Germany, but our contemporary histories also. We have this episode of German migration, temporary, kind of in transit, but nonetheless, it was an important stop. Warsaw, Poland was an important transit country for East Germans fleeing to the West to freedom. Check 3.3.
3 minutes is very soon.
Yes. It should start. Okay. After this. Okay. So let's wait and there will be a guy.
I have to share numbers. There was no palm tree in
1989. yes. The film is from 2009.
One of a personal note of a migration history. When I was studying Polish in London, one of the first Polish people, real Polish people, and apart from my lecturer, was Rajkowska, a famous Polish artist, the author of The Palm Tree, who came to London to explain to students. There weren't that many students studying Polish in London, but I was there, and she was telling the story how she would like to convert the place in Berlin that was to be rebuilt as the Royal Palace into a big swamp, and in a sense, return to the pre-Berlin, the old Slavic history of it being a swamp. And in this way, show the middle finger, the finger that that Felix showed to German imperialism as such.
września 1989 roku wsiadłem do pociągu w Chemnitz. W Dreźnie przesiadłem się do pociągu do Warszawy. Chciałem opuścić NRD. Pół roku wcześniej złożyłem wniosek o zezwolenie na wyjazd. Wiedziałem, że nigdy nie uda mi się szybko dotrzeć na zachód. Znajomy z Polski przysłał mi zaproszenie, żebym mógł się starać o wizę. Po jej załatwieniu pojechałem do Polski. Pociąg zatrzymał się w Görlitz, na tym peronie. Wtedy w pociągach przeprowadzano dokładne kontrole. Kazano wyjąć wszystko z walizek i toreb. Sprawdzano każdy skrawek papieru, czy nie ma numerów telefonów lub adresu krewnych na zachodzie. Stasi szukała śladów świadczących o zamiarze ucieczki. Bardzo się bałem. Pół godziny przed rozpoczęciem kontroli pociąg przejeżdżał przez Budziszyn. Każdy w NRD wiedział, że w Budziszynie jest więzienie Stasi. Pomyślałem, że nic nie może się stać w czasie kontroli. W przeciwnym razie za kilka godzin sam mógłbym się tam znaleźć.
He got an invitation. He wanted to escape to the West. He got an invitation from a Polish colleague to come to Poland. He took a train. He was very afraid of the train control, which was extremely strict. They were checking if he had any contacts in West Germany. So at that time, of course, there were no cell phones, but address books. So he was thoroughly checked because he was really afraid of the secret service at that time. So it shows you sort of the atmosphere of the migration, political migration, at that time.
an interesting story because we as a foundation invited the people out that movies from 2009. It was a 20 anniversary, and it was a presentation in Berlin, and all people have been invited. And 2 years ago, or 2019, we invited them to Warsaw, and there came a group of 30-35 people, and a total different stories. A guy who went to US, another guy who went back to the small town in GDR, is a teacher at the moment, and tried to fight with AFD and the neo-Nazis and so on. But the majority of the people went to the West, and they don't are not interested in any contact with East Germany. With one exception, this guy who went back as a teacher.
They would tear their passports in Warsaw, go to West Germany embassy and apply for a West German passport as an asylum seekers?
Yeah. Okay. Not as asylum, as a GDR citizens, you have had the right to get a West German passport.
Okay.
So thank you very much. Thank you very much for this, for sharing your reflections and your personal histories as well. You know, it can't always be the global politics. Thank you very much. And maybe now let's move to the
students.
Guys, Robbie?
Hello. I'm here and the opportunity to present a poster. My name is Kelly Moyle.
My name is Kelly Moyle.
And there are more members of our group who unfortunately couldn't be here today. Loveli Kiyomi, Kyoto Shunchiha, and Karina Kita. The parts of the essay would be recorded and will be shown on video so we can tell what we're talking about. We are a group of high schoolers from different schools in Kyakuv and Gdańsk who all attend culture study classes here in Kyakuv, organized by the Kyakuv Youth Group Defense of Science and Arts under the patronage of the Jagiellonian University. During our classes, we decided to participate in this project and have spent the past 2 months playing our poster. Each of us provided our welcome parts, and there are four parts to our poster. The first one gives a summarized history of the fall of the Berlin Wall. The second one focuses on current relations between Germany and Poland, with a special emphasis on Kyakuv because of our familiarity with the city. The third one is a series of interviews which we conducted with Poles regarding the fall of the Berlin Wall, the attitudes towards it. The interviews you can read by following the link which has been provided on the poster. And lastly, we chose to write about museums as examples of the results of the education. Based on exhibitions showcased in the Museum of Daniel.
Polina, could you start please? And then we show the records, okay?
So my part of the project was about contemporary relationship between our city, Krakow,
Jewish districts of Krakow, Podgórze and Kazimierz. These relations are going in the right direction. And today, Krakow is a partner city to Frankfurt am Main, Leipzig, and Nuremberg. And in the 90s, there have been two institutions established, Nuremberg House in Krakow and Krakowian House in Nuremberg. And today they're working together in a cultural and educational way to broaden this cooperation.
And the point of the work is lying down with the first turn, depend on and so on. So maybe there is some different areas. The other is the most important reason why the money was divided into four zones of operation. The common policy of free operation allows to the creation of independent federal republic of Germany. The opposite of this, German Democracy Republic was formed, which was fully controlled by Soviet Union. How does Berlin fit into this story? Berlin, as a symbol of Germany, was divided too. It was supposed to symbolize the submission to the occupation. So it was very divided into four parts of the England. But why was the wall built in there? Was the wall needed at all? The main reason of the built wall was the mass migration of people from East Germany. How and why did the very wall fall? The whole Berlin Wall took place a wave of political changes in the country of the Berlin Wall in Europe. There is transformation about the country of nation.
That the most complex and comprehensive. After the museum, the greatest potential space that always gets. First one is the full reaction to the German revolution. Second one, especially vital, is the impact of human experiences on building relations between Poland and Germany. The last part is all about how people in Poland see the German revolution.
I'm living in Greece, and I'm here to present all of you the reflections after visiting the premier. The question about the consequences of unification, political countries, the East and the Western part of Germany. Seems like a one step forward in beginning to identify past experience, the social impact to be seen in post-war socialist countries. The particular aims, the notion of dynamo, could only be seen as a symbol of these changes in forms of nominal. These countries, but also as event in the chain of history. And in that cave, we see the changes done in the mindset and the daily life of the citizens of Western and Western European countries. As an example of that is the Museum of Berlin, located in Macedonian Warsaw. We have availability completely for free, the visiting of the place that gathers researchers from different areas and cultures. The combination previously was in Eastern Prussia, in Germany, right now in association with Poland. The different areas and objects show the difference in daily life and also normally the main things that associated with the people around these cultures and styles they were living. The barrier wall we see furthermore as the domino that resulted in the change of this life, and the visiting of the museum could also be the one by the reflection about these consequences and trying to get the understanding of all these things that happened in the past and trying to comprehend the outcomes of these events. Therefore, what I say is that the Museum of Granievo could be the first for people to get in touch with history, to see the difference and unify with different cultures, to get the inside understanding. Therefore, it's somehow the way to connect the population and show that unification we have to these things happen all around because people gather around in one place to create something would be the opportunity for others to learn about the history. Thank you for listening, and I hope you have your own reflections about even the consequences. Have a nice day. I'm leaving now, and I'm here.
Okay,
that was a very good advertisement. I mean, I would even go to Granada.
More of us.
In a group where I would love to go to Granada.
Yeah, because for pupils, there is the end of the working in the project. So we would like to thank you all for your work, hard work, and for everything what you've done doing your own research. So
thank you.
Yeah. And now we ask students.
Oh, we still have students.
Yeah. from the Institute of European Studies to present their work. okay, wait.
But I know more or less of the place.
My name is Hubert Ostapowicz. I'm a leader of the European Studies Students Group from the Gajda University. as was said earlier, our group consists of me, Susanna Brugger, Natalia Łapaj, Natalia Padas, and Filip Prusak. At first, we want to thank Professor Kinga Gajda, our project supervisor, for her guidance. And we want to speak about the poster that we made about the German unification. As a research, while working on this project, we read literature on the subject and looked at the newspaper articles from the relevant period. And currently, we are surveying our fellow university students, but we unfortunately don't have a results here since we are still getting them. And naturally, posters don't leave much space to exhaust the subject, but we try to convey as much information and bring as many subjects as we can while maintaining the clarity. Looking at the poster, I think that we managed to do that quite well. And I want to give a floor to my colleagues now.
The reunification of Germany is now a history to our generation. We learned about it in our history textbooks, but we never felt the real impact of this event. When I hear about it, I usually think about the song Wind of Change by Scorpions, obviously, which is actually about those events. And this is what I think our generation thinks about German reunification, that it is a symbol of changes and hope for a better future, especially for Eastern Europe. When we try to think about data that we may include in our project, the idea of creating a survey came up. It was the best way to ask other young students about their feeling regarding Polish-German relations. We thought that the opinion of young students is quite important because they are the future of our country and they will be the most important factor in those relations. By now we have received almost 150 responses to the survey, and it is quite satisfying that they want to all participate in our project. Right now we don't have the rough numbers included in the poster, because we want to collect more data and put it in the final version, which we will present in Dresden. Also, we wanted to reach some German students, which is pretty hard, and ask them the same questions that we asked Polish students. The survey showed that youngsters are pretty optimistic about our common future, considering that Polish-German relations are now going to put into a test. It may either conflict us, or it may unite us against common enemy. We believe that especially today, we should consider each other as allies, and it will be hard for Polish people to leave some old prejudices behind, but we need to do this if you want to start a new chapter of cooperation and mutual respect.
So I'm the author of section called Prejudice and Resilience in Operation. My topic of work might seem to be a little bit out of place, especially considering the previous ones. But when I stopped to think about this project, I thought nothing shows how an event is important better than the way of celebrating it. So I thought that I focus on the main events, on three main events. All of which were 30th anniversaries. So it was anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall, of German reunification, and signing the Treaty of Good Neighborhoodship and Friendly Cooperation. As you can see, all those events were held in the past few years. I focus on this subject because I thought that that this might say a few words about recent Polish-German relationship. I mostly wanted to ask who celebrated the events and how they did it. Finding answer to these questions should show a few things. First of all, it shows which groups in Polish society are in good relations with Germany. Secondly, it shows how these relations are important to these groups. My research, as a person, based mostly on checking internet sources. I also use a few digitalized versions of newspapers. I know it's nothing exciting, but seeing what was concluded, I think my work didn't go to pain.
In addition, we thought it would be appropriate to mention about Polish and German relationship in a youth level, so to say. The largest organization works at that field is Polish-German Youth Corporation, which short in Polish is PNWM, and in German PPJW, which we decided to discuss on our poster. Okay, and there was a youth support project and youth meetings, from theater workshop through inter-school experimental projects to field hockey matches. Meetings like that is an important opportunity for the ranking people to get involved and participate in what's like that. They give them the self-confidence and support the personal development. Still, the partnership relationships and actions like that are always supported by the practical knowledge. I decided it's worth to note in that Polish and German cooperation are also works among the young generation, which in the future will be responsible for those relationships at national level. So that is why that is important to start working together as early as possible. So now I would like to give the floor to Hubert again.
So as you can see, I read some Polish newspapers from 1989 and 1990, but unfortunately they are quite blurry in here. So I want to say about them that almost all news about the German unification or fall of the Berlin Wall was positioned on the first pages of the Polish newspapers. Are, for example, headlines from the Gazeta Wyborcza and Gazeta Krakowska, some two of the Polish newspapers from the relevant period. And if I may say one thing, as it was said earlier, that most of the Poles didn't expect that you're gonna think Germany is so in this period. In one of these newspapers, at the 25th of the September of the 1989, I read that there is no chance, it's impossible for the Germany to ever reunite. So that's all I can say about these newspapers from this perspective.
So first of all, I'd like to say that when I was preparing the project, I felt ashamed that the poster don't give us the maneuverability to discuss some things that are important. For example, the minorities in Stettin, currently, and maybe Breslau, Katowice, Hindenburg, now, etc. Because that's a very important topic, and I think that my colleagues share the same opinion that they would like to talk more about our relationships, our cultures, and future in the past of our countries. So maybe I will say something about things that failed quite ago as we planned. So we contacted an gas newspaper and made them even in the radio, but sadly we didn't have any feedback from them. But we contacted an MP from German minority, Mr. Richard Gala, and the office said that they are very positive with the cooperation with us, but sadly to the busy schedule of Mr. MP, we have to reschedule it, postpone it to after our today's presentation. So hopefully in Dresden we will have our home interview. And of course, now in the current situation, we cannot, we have to speak about the situation in the East that's happening now in our times. So I suppose that now, since the 30 years of our cooperation that we have with Germany, between Poland and Germany, and the cooperation, the ideological and economical cooperation, our relations are put to a test. When Russia attacked Ukraine, all of our common values was violated. The values of EU, of our own countries, Western countries, were violated. And despite political differences, cultural differences, we should focus on the things that unite us all and stand strong against the common threat. And it's our joint response that will have a huge impact on the future development of Ukrainian nations. And it is thanks to a common position of Russia, oil and gas, that will ensure energy support, energy security. And we have to realize that cutting the Bulgarian and Polish states from the gas is not only that's not a situation that only affects Poland, but we have to see that it's a warning and a blackmail for Germany and whole of Europe and European nations. And the visit of Vice Chancellor Robert Habeck sets the path for us to follow, and that we have to cooperate between our own countries, between Poland and Germany, to have that security. And 30 years of cultural and economic and ideological cooperation is enough, and now we must do the same for the Ukraine.
Don't be afraid, you are not going to sink.
It's a pity.
Well, I would like to first of all thank Professor Kinga Gajda for hosting us here and for the wonderful work with the students, both pupils from the high school, and the video was amazing, and the students from the Jagiellonian University. We look forward to having you in Dresden and showing the posters and comparing it with other countries. I think it will be extremely interesting. Thank you for your work. You did a great job. Of course, you have something to finish, but it's always like this with research. It's not a short thing, never. So thank you so much. And I also, of course, want to thank all the panelists and participants and our guests, project partners, for coming to Kraków. I'm happy to share with you my passion for the city. Jagiellonian University is the university I graduated from, and I teach one class. So here, so I'm quite proud of this. Thank you for being here and for your participation. And my dear colleague Adam.
Okay, probably nothing has left for me to say.
Thank you.
But I would like to thank you very much. I really appreciate your work. It was really great. The two posters, great posters, and of course this video. And we'll meet you will meet with other students in Dresden pretty soon in September. It will be a great opportunity for all of you to share your works and your posters, that will create a common exhibition. And of course,
online. Thank you.
Yeah, I would like to, of course, I would like to thank all our partners and viewers that have watched us online. And of course, all partners who showed up in person, from Florian and Jana and Shika. And we are seeing pretty soon in Liberec in Czechia. Thank you very much.